Don't buy into it. Don't fight it off. Fight it off. And we are live, folks. Welcome to the Sit Down Standard, the podcast celebrating all the amazing things you can do while sitting, whether it's enjoying movies, watching television, or playing games. I'm one of your hosts, David Bray. I am joined by my suicide squad here. We've got Gerald Bales.
Hi.
And our special guest, Sarah Flores Bales.
Suicide.
And that all that means is that you guys like your Slurpees mixed, right?
Any soda.
Do you still go suicide with your soda?
No. Slurpee's the only thing that goes suicide now as a grown adult.
Yeah, but...
But before it was like, we're doing Mountain Dew, we're doing a little Coke here, you know.
Pina colada? You mixing all that stuff together?
Mix it up, man.
Fruit punch and the Coca-Cola?
You know what's good, David, okay. And fans out there? The Hawaiian punch Slurpee mixed with pina colada Slurpee.
Yeah, that is actually pretty good.
And rum.
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
Have you tried the cake batter Slurpee?
Yes, it's actually not too bad, David. It's pretty good.
It's just sugar.
It is vanilla.
It's just vanilla cookie. Yeah. Okay. Well, if you are listening to the show, remember we do not live, but YouTube versions of our show. You can come watch our video podcast on YouTube.
See our faces.
YouTube.com/sitdownstandard. We also put the audio version up on iTunes, SoundCloud, as well as Stitcher Radio, and now Google Play Store. Speaking of Google Play Store, we got a confirmation from one of our viewers, and then he sent in an email.
Oh, okay.
So, Mike K. from California.
As long as someone uses Google, it's got to help Google out. You know, it's such a small company.
Yeah, exactly.
It's the American version of him.
Yes. We got an email from Mike K., who gave us a suggestion, something to do, something to play.
Okay.
He writes...
Types.
Types, whatever.
Did he deliver a real letter?
No, it's not a real
letter. That'd be so
It's a pigeon.
Cool. The first person who sent us a real letter.
Someone did. Do you remember that back in the day? Secret Fun Sauce sent us
a handwritten letter.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's true. I was going to say you're getting a $10 gift card instead of five.
So Mike will be getting a $5 gift card. I'll get in touch with him. But he writes.
He's going to choose Starbucks.
You guys and girls. He didn't write that.
Thank you. You guys may want to trigger her, okay?
You guys may want to check this out if you haven't already. He's talking about Jackbox Games.
Okay.
They have a few different party type games. You may run the app on your Xbox or whatever people play using their phone. So there's a part that's on a console, and then there's a part that the people interact with their phone. He said he's played a game called Drawful as well as Quiplash.
Yes.
Is that what it's called?
Mm-hmm.
And it went over great. He did say a little alcohol helped.
Of course.
Social lubrication is what we call that.
Always.
In the board game world.
He says it's super easy for non-tech people to get involved. So you can go to jackboxgames.com. They just came out, I think, with a second version of their...
Well, David, we have experience playing this.
Okay,
they had the Jackbox Party Pack on Xbox One. Mm-hmm. And yeah, they just came out with the second one, I think, a few months ago.
But the one he's talking about, Drawful, I've had a chance to play that. It's kind
we
of
We played it on the first mm-hmm. one, yeah.
Yeah, we played that.
It ultimately devolves to people drawing, you know, bad things.
Of course, especially with the alcohol that he mentioned.
Yeah, so the way the game works is one person is on their phone is given what to draw.
Mm-hmm.
And then everybody else on their phone...
Everyone's drawing something.
They all get a clue, like a clue of something to draw.
Draw this. And a lot of it stuff's like ridiculous
like
stuff.
A like a zebra eating ice cream.
Yeah.
Presidential penguin.
Yeah, something weird, right? And so then what ends up happening after everyone has drawn their specific clue, then those people's...
It's put up on the screen, and it's like, what do you think this is?
Right.
So then people write on their phones again, so no one else sees what they think the drawing is without knowing the real title.
Right.
And then it flashes up on the screen of everyone's suggestions with the real one, and then your job is to guess what's the real one.
Yeah.
And if people guess your suggestion...
You get points for tricking other players.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a ton of fun, and it only works because now we're flooded with all the smartphones. Which is cool.
You don't need a specific controller, you know. You're not going to give your friend the Mad Cats controller. Everyone has the mobile browser on the phone, just pop it up and it's all there.
It's super cool. So yeah, definitely. I haven't played Quiplash. We've only seen Quiplash,
but I think Quiplash is included in the second party pack that we don't have.
And I think the second one probably gives more to it. You know, it's the second version of it. I haven't played it yet. I want to check it out. It was on Steam recently and picked that up. Because it's so, like he talks about, it's for non-tech people, it's fantastic. So can't recommend that
enough.
It's
pretty straightforward.
Did you play any of the old games, David?
Like the You Don't Know Jack stuff?
Oh, yeah.
A little bit, not like...
Cookie Masterson?
Most. Well, see, the thing is we would, you know, the elite in me would just play Trivial like Pursuit and stuff like that. But it's more pop culture.
But it's more funny.
Yeah. Yeah, and like you could screw your neighbor. Right. There was like more of like a take that part to it, like Uno. Mm-hmm. But no, I'm not a huge fan of it.
I like trivia games. I had a bunch of them on CD-ROM.
See, we used to play Jeopardy on NES, but we would play it. We were kids, so we didn't
know. Double Dare on the.
Yeah, but here's the thing with Jeopardy that like it only had like a certain amount of questions. So eventually, we would just know all the answers, and then we'd like invite our friend over that didn't know, and we would look like the smartest person ever.
Just get the first couple wrong. That's messed up. Darn! But the $800 question you get right.
It's like, who wrote this novel back in 1840s? As an 8-year-old, I know. I don't remember any of it, but yeah, thank you for the email. I'll reach out to you, Mike, and you can pick. Remember, if you send us an email, ask a question, give a suggestion, whatever, ask us anything. It's called Ask Sit Down Standard. You get a $5 gift card to Amazon, Steam, or Starbucks.
Yeah. I think I'm gonna send mine via Pug.
There you go.
Yeah.
Pug Messenger. It's like a raven.
Exactly.
A lot slower.
It's like a pigeon.
All right. Okay. Now that we got through the email, again, thank you, Mike. Let's start the podcast with what we start every podcast with.
David singing.
What you doing? Oh, what you doing? What you doing? Ba-da-da-da. That's Joker, kind of.
The terrible laugh, just like Jared Leto does. Yeah. More on that later.
We'll get
that's
to that.
That's a tease. Yeah, that's feed the baby birds, David.
All right. Let's start with Gerald, since you're on the end on this episode. What you doing, Gerald? What you
up to? I got a bunch of stuff this week, David. All right, cool. I'm trying to fit as much stuff in as I can. Gerald's weekly Overwatch update.
Oh, here we go.
Do we have a soundbite for this?
We should.
Anyway, some new content, David. Yes. We got the summer games going on, and they created this tie-in with Overwatch. It's not tied into the Olympics directly.
It is.
It doesn't say Rio 2016, but the map is in Rio, the soccer thing, and then everyone has new skins. There's over 90 new cosmetic items, David.
Yeah.
That you can get by buying the loot boxes, special summer games loot boxes, and you get
cha-ching, cha-ching.
Well, that's the thing that people are upset about, because like if you have duplicates on items, you get in-game currency, just gold or whatever, and you can use that gold to buy skins that you haven't gotten in the loot boxes.
You can't do that. No.
You can't use it with the summer game skins. It's a limited event, so it ends on the 22nd. So if you want those cool skins, you got till the 22nd to get them, I guess.
I don't get that upset because, I mean, I get upset because it constantly feels like, hey, you know that 10% of our audience that will do anything that we want them to? Let's just, you know, rip them off with all these crappy skins. And it's like, I'm not
part of... There's some cool skins in that, David. I will attest to that.
I bet you will.
Torb's got a cool Swedish thing that I unlocked the other day.
This is the 10% I'm talking about.
Hey, I didn't spend any real money.
Yeah, but
when you level up, you get one loot box.
Okay.
And then they give you one when you first start the summer games.
Well, I know one of the new... There's like a new mode that came out with the summer games thing.
So, well, every week they switch it up with what's called the weekly brawl. So they'd be like, oh, now only these... You can only select these three heroes and like hijinks, stuff like that. This week they introduced a new game with the summer games called Lucio Ball. Lucio's a support character in the game. He has
Lucille Ball?
Thing. No, Lucio.
How awesome would that be?
Lucio Ball.
She shows up.
Gotcha.
And, I don't know.
If anyone knows what Rocket League is, it's that, but with Lucio.
Yeah, you have like
a big soccer ball and you got a squirt goal.
Yeah, and one of his abilities is like pushing. So you can use his gun to like send like a shockwave to push the ball and you try to get it in the goal, which is cool.
It's 3v3.
It's fun.
It's a good way to get actually experience. Because you get the same amount of experience as you would in a game.
I thought you meant like learning how to play the character.
Oh, no.
Because normally it's like, you know, you kill the other team. And this, you're just trying to soccer, right?
So, yeah, it's fun.
Anyways, okay, cool.
But yeah, it's cool. Check it out, Overwatch. Hopefully we'll have something for you next week. They have to keep coming up with new content weekly just so I can keep talking about
it. Yeah, exactly. Blizzard, you get the cash in those checks yet or no?
Right.
I wish.
Speaking of the summer games, David, the opening ceremonies were yesterday.
Yes.
Last night. Well, as we're recording this.
Yeah.
Did you watch it at all?
I did not.
Un-American.
Well, see, I normally do. I think, you know, the problem is now YouTube. They're on YouTube, so I'll watch them on YouTube. I won't watch them live. Plus, what's the time difference? It's got to be, I mean, it's not that much different.
No, I think they showed it. They started showing it at like 4 o'clock in the afternoon here.
That's the thing. It's like, it's not like, no, I want it to be at like 8 p.m.
Well, we watched it. It must have been a rebroadcast.
Yeah, it was a rebroadcast, yeah.
So how was it?
It was interesting. They said from the very beginning, like, we don't have the kind of resources that Sochi or London did. So instead of doing these crazy, ridiculous displays, it's all centralized around a giant projection screen.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like you've seen the newer basketball courts and hockey rinks and stuff do. So a lot of the stuff was centralized around that. It was kind of boring to me, honestly. And then it was all kind of overshadowed by the fact that, like 25% of their population is unemployed and they have all these crime issues.
Yeah,
and
there's
the sewage in the water, all the controversy behind the game.
I was reading an article that says like they had like the top 40 most dangerous cities, and I think like 20 of them are in Brazil.
And it's just the corruption. It's just
no, it's just
it's
really
kind of weird. All that stuff is overshadowed.
No, but it does bring awareness. I mean, at the end of the day, it's good that, you know, the silver lining here is that maybe they'll get some help, you know, in some way, or at least it might, you know, I don't know.
But anyway, well, I mean, sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, they do this. Internet, they do this. They like just completely talk bad about something. I actually enjoyed it.
I very much enjoyed the show.
Like, I enjoyed the dancing. I enjoyed.
I'm just saying the Olympics in general in Rio, just kind of a mess. But
well, yeah, and I think the health thing, like, it's crazy to, you know. Not even that. It's just like the water contaminations and stuff like that. Like,
but if you're gonna send somebody, send like the most healthiest athletes we have. I mean, they can take it.
But hey, just don't swallow. What did they say? 3 teaspoons of water, and you'll be fine. Three teaspoons, which equals 1 tablespoon, right?
They shouldn't even be worried about the water. They should be worried about what's happening in their Olympic village.
Yeah. Anyways.
But yeah, it's just crazy to me that, you know, because I don't know how the Olympic Committee picks it. I'm sure there's some cash involved. Yeah.
Brazil or Rio beat out Chicago.
Right. And I'm also, there's obviously a ton of politics involved in it, but I always enjoy the spectacle of it all. And I love maybe as an American, I don't think we get into it enough. You know, we do.
I don't care about any of these sports except during the Olympics, you know, and so patriotic.
It's not even that. It's just like, how many golds are we leading in gold? Are we leading? And if we're not leading in gold, we're like, are we leading in all medals?
We got the first gold, David. Do you know what it was
what
in?
I mean? See what I mean?
Do you know what it was in?
What was it in?
Shooting.
Of course it was.
We know that, right?
All right. Anyways.
Well, anyway, so they didn't enjoy it. I very much enjoyed it. I liked it.
Hated on it?
No, I'm talking about my husband. I'm telling the internet this is what my husband does.
The ceremony was fine. It was fine.
It was just okay?
Kind of boring. Yeah, it was okay.
I liked it.
Did they have like, is it like, they have the, you know, a particular like group of people for each country and they come in with their flag and they do all that. They usually do that. And then they do that after the opening ceremonies.
And okay, so this is the thing that was kind of like get off my lawn with national broadcast, but like how many commercials were there taking a break during the opening ceremony, taking a break when every single break would be like, we're coming up on, you guessed it, Michael Phelps leading the flag, United States of America coming up. But it's like, yeah, that's you. We just started with A. And every commercial break, they mention that. Every commercial break, it's like, we get it.
Oh, I get it. Okay, well, I mean, unfortunately, it says more about the American audience than anything. Like, the only reason we're watching.
Media, yeah. So Gerald actually didn't even watch the nations come in. So
no,
first of all.
No, I didn't watch.
Second of all,
right.
What was hilarious is that, okay, so after the Americans come in, they show, like, the pit that they're in, all the athletes
the
coming in.
The party area, right?
Yeah, and then, like, they show the other nations coming in. So other people from other nations went up to behind where the people were standing that were directing them to like see the other people coming in. The Americans were just shown nothing but shots of like taking like pictures of themselves and like saying like USA, USA, and like completely like not even interested in what was actually happening. But you saw other people from other countries like go up to see the other countries come through. So I just thought that was pretty funny. Like, of course America's just taking pictures of themselves.
Well,
like,
we're the best country, so I mean, come on.
What is it they say, like, the one thing, the thing that we're number one in the world is like confidence.
Exactly.
But however, I want to talk about Tonga.
I heard about this
of Tonga.
Oh, this oiled
this
up
dude.
Yeah,
oh my gosh,
show a picture.
He wins.
I will.
Yeah, look, he's just zoom in. Zoom in.
All glistened up.
Yes.
There.
That was amazing.
Good for,
he
for
wins.
You, Tonga.
Good
he,
for you.
He wins. Tonga that country
gets
just
a medal.
Wins.
Medal.
Yeah.
I wonder if they would start awarding medals for like the opening ceremony. You did the best.
I'm
you
waiting till they do the red carpet of like, oh my God, look at what Michael Phelps and the Team USA is wearing. Oh
well, they
God.
Weren't doing that like on the TV show, but like on Twitter and stuff like that. They were doing that like about what people from other countries were wearing and stuff like that. God, a lot of the big name like fashion, like I think Louis Vuitton did, I think he did Cuba or something like that. Like,
that's awesome though.
I don't know who did ours. I assume Ralph Lauren did ours for America because they had like the big like polo,
oh, the polo
logo.
Symbols.
Yeah.
The reason I like the Olympics is it's one of the few times, and it's not everyone in the world, but it feels, you know, like there's a large majority of the world watching one thing at one
it's
time.
Like a World Cup.
Well, yeah, it's just really cool. Like the idea of like, hey, all of these countries, like the world, let's get together and play some games. Yeah. Like,
that's
that. Awesome. Like,
not just that, but the political turmoil that's in our country right now, this is the one time America gets together and be like, let's just beat all the other countries in the world.
Yeah.
We can all agree on that. Common enemies. Yeah,
exactly.
I got you. Okay.
So in a way to bring this back to Disney, as I always do.
Of course.
I was like, thanks to the Disney Company and the Three Caballeros and a documentary called Walt and El Grupo, I've like been obsessed with the idea of going to Rio de Janeiro. Like, that's always been like my dream. Like, I want to go so bad. So,
bucket list type of thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Just wait till
we
have enough money.
I was so
I
excited.
Pay off the ransomers when they kidnap you.
Anyway, so I was so excited, you know, this year. And then like at the end when they finally announced Brazil coming through, like they played one of the songs and I was like crying and I was like, this is awesome. And they did like a big carnival thing at the end, which was really awesome. So
yeah. It's cool. It's like everybody, every country gets to play its best cards, which is great, you know, because it rarely happens. Most of the time.
And they spend their whole, like, 4 years, every 4 years. You
and
know,
that's what's
this is all they do.
This, yeah. And that's what's cool about it. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's this,
it's cool. Like, a lot of people in the, they were, like, interviewing Phelps and all that stuff, of course, and that one gymnast or whatever, I forgot her name. But everyone, all the other Team USA in the back, they're in the stands on their phones, they're like, you know, on TV and stuff. Because, like, this is their moment, you know?
That, it's cool. And they're, like, kids. A lot of those, they're, like, young,
like
young
18,
athletes.
19-year-old kids. Yeah, it's insane.
They're like, you need to, you represent a country. It's like, he's 19. He just, like, learned how to drive a few years ago. Like, take it easy.
He's been doing this his whole life, so.
All right, other than Olympics, what else you got going on?
Got a call from my grandpa, David, the other day.
This is great.
That
this
he was
awesome.
Hacked by the Chinese and the Russians.
Yeah?
And this is just a little get off my lawn here. People, just so you know, no one's hacking you. Like, no one cares about your email, what's in your email. No one cares. If you get a call from someone who wants to get on your computer, don't do it.
Don't do it.
Yeah, unless, like, you know it's them. Pretty much, he called Cox because...
that's the cable
he had to
company?
Figure out, yeah, he had a problem with his email, called Cox. They told him it's not that. You need to call Gmail. Not cool. Google. You need to call Gmail, David.
Call Gmail.
I didn't know you could call Gmail.
Cox gave my grandpa Gmail's number. Gmail's number was not Gmail's number. It was just one of those companies that, you know, call you to be like, oh, let me get on a computer. You have all these viruses and stuff. Proceeded to, yeah, get $200, which he reversed, which is good. But just like, people just be wary out there. They like, these companies like to prey on
people who don't know what they're doing.
People don't know, you know, like ignorant people and all that kind of stuff. Just, you know, be wary.
Look out. It sucks. That just sucks. That's sad, man.
Yeah.
It just...
But he called me and he's like...
There's a special
they're
place
on my computer
in hell
right now.
For people like that. That, yeah. Like, prey on, like, old people and, like, yeah. People who don't know what they're doing. It's just like...
They're on my computer right now. They sold me this thing. I'm like, okay, close the lid right now. I'm coming over. Just close the lid.
Yeah.
Hang up the call. Right. Call American Express. Get that reversed. I'm on my way.
Yeah. That's just good that he got... People, it's good. Yeah. See, that's the thing. It's good that American Express and stuff like that at least helps him out. But it's just... I don't know.
Just be wary, people.
It's weird because, like, you know, with... You know, do you answer phones, like calls from numbers that don't show up with like a name?
Yeah, every time.
You never answer?
No, I always answer.
You always answer?
Every single call, yeah.
See, I'm more of, it's like, you know, like back, let's say 15 years ago, someone knocks on your door. No big deal. Someone knocks on your door now and you don't know they're coming over. It's like DEFCON 5. Like, answer the red phone. Like, what's going on?
Well, yeah, us, because like our dogs go crazy and it's like, oh my God, it's the door. Then you're like,
No, but I'm just saying, like, I don't know. The invention of cell phones have changed that because no one just goes over to people's houses and says, hey, are you home? Because like they would call you and be like, are you home?
Yeah.
So it's just, I think part of that is it's, you know, no one answers on or,
I just answer the calls because like if it is like a marketer, I'll go through the thing really quick. Take me off your list, please, and then not get the call again. Instead of just constantly getting calls, you know, once a week.
I like the one that's like, can you hear me? And it's like a recording. I always go, no.
And then
as if I would answer. And they're like, are you sure? No. And then they just hang up.
I did get a call from like one of the people like, oh, hey, I'm from Microsoft. You know, found some viruses on your computer. Can you get me on? I'm like, oh, yeah. And you know, I'm a tech guy. I know.
Yeah, so you messed with them.
Yeah, so I messed up. I'm like, I don't know. All I have is this Apple icon. What's this mean? You know, where's the window at?
Where's the any key?
Hang up on me. So
yeah,
they know.
That sucks that there's a whole industry involved in that.
It does suck, but it's like just be wary, people. You know, don't click on email attachments you're not expecting.
I would imagine people are listening to a podcast or on YouTube probably aren't in the audience that you're talking about. But tell the people that you love not to.
Yeah,
you never know.
Yeah, exactly.
It just sucks. Okay.
Last thing, I saw another other than Suicide Squad, which we'll get to later.
Yeah,
I saw another movie this week with my beautiful wife here. We went to see Mila Kunis' movie, Bad Moms.
Kristen Bell, too. Come on, don't be...
I'm Mila Kunis. Well, go see Bad Moms.
Yeah, there was a funny ad, you know, the Cinemark trailer for it. She has masterpiece. Anyway, actually, really good. I enjoyed this movie.
See, it was really good, yeah.
I have a question. Is this... I don't know if it's the same production company, but are they... Like, we had Bad Santa, Bad Teacher, Bad Moms. Is that
No, I think it's just a naming.
Yeah.
It's literally just like...
Just a word.
I just didn't know if like they're... Obviously, it's the same theme running through it. It's like...
These people are normally good, but they're bad. Whoa.
Right. Man. So, it's actually really good. Like,
it's
really
solid.
Enjoyable.
Like, it's rated R.
It's better than Batman versus Superman.
Stop it! You had to do that. Didn't
I had
you?
To.
I didn't
I
do
had
this
to.
Time.
Okay,
but it's really good. What's the redhead's name?
You have the internet. You can look it up. I want to ask you a question. So, it seems from the trailers that some of them are single moms. Or Mila Kunis is a single mom.
Well, spoiler alert, she becomes a single mom.
Well, no, I think that's in the trailer. It's pretty obvious that she's a single mom. But,
she doesn't start out that way.
Okay, well, and then she's like in the, she's like, the PTA moms are like the cool, the good moms that know how to do everything. And she's like, I can't get all this stuff done. I got to juggle a business life.
I'm
and
a single
kids.
Mom. Yeah.
See, it was in the trailer, single mom. I wouldn't have even picked out that she wasn't. But then she eventually is like, screw it. Like, I want to have fun and I don't want to just live for my kids.
I want to be a quote unquote bad mom.
Okay. And so, and then, okay.
Parties. But it's like rated R humor. So like,
is it rated R?
Yeah, it's rated R.
Oh, good.
But they talk. Yeah, that's just the kind of humor it is. And it's freaking hilarious. And I wrote some notes here. I said predictable story, but good writing, like the jokes and everything was solid. Right. But it's just one of those movies.
Well, Mila Kunis and Kristen Bell, I know they're like actual real world friends. So that.
Oh, are they really?
Yeah, I think, yeah.
How do you know that, dude?
Well, Dax Shepard and what's his face? Ashton Kutcher are good friends too. Ashton Kutcher and Dax Shepard. They used to do Punk'd together.
They were on Punk'd. I forgot about that.
So they've been friends for a long time. So it's, you know, it's, that makes it, so I would imagine
and
the chemistry.
And they were in Forgetting Sarah Marshall.
Ashton Kutcher?
No.
Oh, Kristen Bell and Mila Kunis. So they've worked together. Yeah. So there's a lot of chemistry there. So I'd imagine that's really good. I do like the problem that I always have with very attractive women playing these roles is they like make fun of like, oh, you don't look sexy in that mom bra. It's like, no, she still does.
Okay, so there's a scene.
This is the thing that Sarah and I were talking about during the movie.
Yeah,
like Kristen Bell, like she's gorgeous, right?
Right. So is
but
Mila
she plays as like a mom who has like four kids, homeschools them. So she's like tussled her hair a little bit, throw in a gross ponytail, and wear like a sweatshirt.
Yeah,
and it's like, oh, she's ugly.
Yeah,
it's a, yeah, exactly.
And then like they try to do this exact same to Mila Kunis, make her look a little
but
bit
you
more
left
tired.
Him.
Like,
let's go out.
Yeah,
let's
and like her hair is like messed up and it's like, but she still looks beautiful. There's no way. And then so there's a part where they're out at a bar trolling for guys.
She's trying to pick up guys.
Yeah, she's trying to pick up and they're like
Mila
turning
Kunis.
Her down left and right. Like 10 guys in like 2 seconds are like,
when she says something like,
down.
Oh, I have a kid and they walk away, it's like, it's Mila Kunis. Like, I don't care.
Right, exactly.
This is only going to be a one night thing anyway.
It is very unrealistic.
That's a Hollywood problem, right? I mean, they're not going to pick some, you know, that's just how it works.
But the other mom
it's
and her crew.
It's the same thing with, like, remember that show Ugly Betty? I think is what it was called.
Yeah.
And, like, the girl was gorgeous, but they're like, put glasses on her and give her, like, a
frizzy hair.
Right. And it's like, okay. Like, guys can see past that.
Yeah.
And same thing with girls. They're like, we can fix you.
But anyway, so the third girl in, like, the group is played by Catherine Hahn.
Yeah.
And she's been in stuff, Parks and Recreation. She had an arc in and State Golden Pony Boy. And, like, she
Step
steals
Brothers.
This movie. She is freaking hilarious.
That's
she's
awesome.
Really good, yeah.
So she steals a movie. I said that redhead steals a movie. J.J. Watt has a little cameo.
I heard
this
about
movie.
That.
He
yep.
should stick to football.
Yes, definitely stick to football.
Oh,
it's not
bad.
Great.
Well, he's done cameos on, like, The League and stuff like that, but. Is he playing himself?
No, he plays a soccer coach.
Okay, because on The League, he's playing J.J. Watt.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
He's like a meathead on there, and it's like, he's a meathead.
No, actually, he's just, his acting is not very well. So.
Yeah, he's no Green Bay Packers offensive line.
I'm going to say you're no John Cena.
All right, anyways.
I say Jada Pinkett Smith. Okay, so Jada Pinkett Smith is on one of the Mean Moms with Christina Applegate. And I said, I noted, Jada Pinkett Smith is the Will Smith of this movie. Because there's so many times she has like the one-liners like, you heard what she said, and just keeps walking.
Yeah, that's
like
great.
Something like that.
That's
like,
great.
Stupid. But I don't know if it was like a meta joke. Like,
I think it's got to be a little bit.
But anyway, I just had to get off my lawn here, David.
God, you had a lot this week, man.
Yeah.
Angry at the
try
world.
Try every day, David.
Okay, so we're in this movie theater watching Bad Moms. Not a crowded theater. You know, we're not
It was
right
a Monday night.
But people who like... Okay, so like there's a joke that happens on screen. Oh, she said I don't do that anymore. Like they repeat the joke. She said this. You know what I mean?
No, I'm confused.
So if a joke happens on the screen.
Oh,
let's say
they're having commentary
Mila Kunis
about
says,
this, right.
I'm not going to do that for you anymore. And then the guy says, she says she's not going to do that anymore, like repeating the jokes.
Right, like a commentary. You're having like your I'm always and this is most people don't do this, but I'm like I think it's either one of two things. One, either you just don't care that like other people are in the theater with you, or you're just so into the movie that you forget
we'll see,
that you're in a theater with
so,
a bunch of people.
It's like everything that happened, though, they would be like, oh, no.
Man, or, there's a guy in like the front row or something that'd be like, he would laugh at the jokes or say, you know, respond to the jokes, but like 200%, 300% more than everyone else. So like gasp out laughing, all that kind of stuff. It's like, dude, calm down, something funny.
No, he didn't. I think I heard that.
Yeah.
Like at least once.
It's okay. I mean, it depends on the movie. If it's a comedy, I'll at least forgive it. Like if it's something that's supposed to be tense and like silence is the part of it that is creating the tension, then like shut up.
Yeah.
But in a comedy, it's okay. Actually, sometimes it actually lends like like levity. I don't know. There's times where I remember I went and saw Sixth Sense.
It's good seeing people's reactions. You know?
No. But we
it's
went
almost like when you laugh at something, you look at the person and see if they're laughing.
Right,
too,
right, so, right. Yeah. I remember seeing Sixth Sense, and there's that part where you find out that you guys have both seen Sixth Sense.
Yes. Yeah,
spoiler alert.
Whoa, okay, no.
Here comes the spoiler alert from a movie that came out like 10 years ago. There's the part where she's being poisoned by her mother mm-hmm. to keep her sick.
Yeah.
I was sitting next to this like little kid, not like probably like 8 or 9 or 10, which I was like, why are you taking this kid to this movie? It's a terrible, it's like really depressing movie. And I think this is the second time I saw it because I went and saw it and I was like, oh my God. And then I had to go see it with my friends because you're like all staring at them.
This M. Night guy is great. Yeah.
So anyways, the little kid goes, oh my gosh, she's poisoning her, like so loud and like so like serious that I couldn't hold back and I just burst out laughing, which is like totally not appropriate,
especially during that scene. Yeah,
exactly. But because I had seen it, like it wasn't shocking to me, it was just funny to see like how much shock
and
it created. And so I just laughed and everyone's like,
because everyone's thinking that in their mind, but it's a little kid.
What's wrong with you, you soulless monster? So that was always, like I said, sometimes it's worth it if people kind of jump in the movie.
Yeah.
Anything else?
No, Sarah, what you doing this week?
Well, actually, I wanted to add on to Bad Moms here.
Okay.
I don't mean to, you know, gloat or anything, but after I saw the movie, I tweeted that J.J. Watt and Wanda Sykes were really great cameos, and the official Wanda Sykes' Twitter liked my tweet. So
there you go.
Whoa.
I'm just saying, you know, me and her, we're good friends now.
That social media presence.
Yeah. But this week, I read a book, which is...
You read a book?
I read a book. Yeah.
What book did you read?
I read Harry Potter and the Cursed Child.
That's the new...
The play.
Yeah, it's considered the eighth book now.
And it's written by J.K. Rowling.
So it's a screenplay... with that J.K. Rowling had an influence with the story.
Yeah.
But there were two screenwriters that wrote the script for it.
And is there
not
plans to make this into
there
a feature film?
Well, right now it's a play. It's a two-night play.
Oh, really?
Two-night, yeah.
Yeah.
Really?
That's like a
thing?
5-hour play, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a thing?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And, like,
I didn't know that they did that.
Sold out.
So then they actually just took that and then they put it like they do like
yeah. When you read the book, it's a script. It's
oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Or play script.
And it's it involves Mr. Potter.
Of course.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, J.K.
Sarah, don't
Rowling.
Spoil anything.
Don't.
I don't give a I'm sorry.
Nice.
David. I'm sorry.
Good job. So, I'm going to have to bleep all of that
I'm
out.
I'm sorry.
Our Harry Potter listeners have virgin ears, okay? Anyways, continue.
So, she said that this book is canon, and it's going to be the end of the Harry Potter
She said
series.
That about the last book.
But I mean,
until they offer her more money.
Maybe.
Well, it's funny, like Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them is coming out in November. It's her first, like she wrote the script with, I'm assuming with other people, but it's a story all by her that wasn't a book and this will be the first time.
Was it on a train? Because that's the only way I'm going to, just kidding. We've had that
You
discussion.
Still haven't seen them all, huh, David?
I have not. What's actually,
for shame.
What was the last one you saw?
The last one, see, this is the problem. They all blend together. Because you know what it was? I got fatigue on the Harry Potter thing because...
They were cranking them out like every year.
They were kids, so it's like they grow up. It's like we gotta get this thing done.
Yeah.
You know, I think what it was is I enjoyed like the first movies because they were like whimsical and about like as a kid you always would play in your backyard with like a stick and be like, you know, hocus pocus or whatever. And that was, I enjoyed that part of it. And then it took like this super dark turn of like black magic and everything's out to kill you and Harry Potter and the prophecy, and I'm just like, that's too heavy. Like
I enjoy that.
I can
well, it's
see
because the readers grew up
and
starting
I,
as a kid.
And I've never grown up, guys. I don't want to grow up.
That's true.
But I think that's why I kind of checked out, just because like in the part where I was like, you got it on the nose, is like one of the characters' names is Sirius Black, and I was like, yep, you got it. Like that's what this all turned into. And I'm like, it's not what I was looking for in that. And I see the draw. Like the characters are fantastic. And I think just the movies became too serious. I wanted them to be more whimsical, like what is it called? The first one's the Sorcerer's Stone, or mm-hmm. it's a different
the
name.
The Philosopher's Stone.
And then the second one's Chamber of Secrets. And this, again, I know we always mention bows, but we used to show scenes from that, and I love that
the
movie.
The Basculus scene at the end?
It was actually, it was the flying car. And I just remember, your hands are all sweaty! And he tried to grab them. And then the screaming pots.
Which is
the Drakes, because it's a great
They're
surround.
They're mandrakes, David.
Mandrakes.
Yeah, I said
mandrakes.
Mandrakes.
David just said Drake.
Whatever. Started from the bottom.
Not
now they're screaming.
Hotline bling over here.
Anyways, so I enjoyed the whimsical part of it. In the
learning and like, so you, yeah, like you always said, superhero movies. You like the origin.
I like the origin, like learning their powers and like the Jinx. Like and the.
But they do that throughout like the whole series. Like,
right.
No, but it does get dark.
It becomes about like the family prophecy, and it becomes about the
There's
one we
murder right. and like something and
that's like
that.
Like right up my alley.
Right. And I like I said, but
right
anyway, so this
alley.
This is
stupid.
He said it.
Said it was good.
So I didn't read the books growing up.
You've read all of them though, right?
No, I haven't.
Oh, really? Okay.
I've just only been a fan of the movies. Right. I really like the movies. I actually just finished knitting and crocheting scarves for my pugs for their prospective Hogwarts houses.
Nice.
And
do you think
so,
they'll reject it? They'll be like, I don't know, Slytherin,
get
out of here.
They're already so over it. So, yeah. So I don't know. I really enjoyed the book. Because I kind of feel like I don't really think I can go back and read like the whole series because I'm like, I can't really relate to anybody as a child, but I kind of was a little bit excited for this book because I was like, oh, maybe I can relate a little bit more to Harry Potter as an adult. So
in this, he's an adult.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, that's cool.
He's like 30 something.
He's like, oh, I got to pay these bills. He's like, hocus pocus, it's gone. IRS. No, but I, you know, the thing with J.K. Rowling is at this point, it's become, she's so synonymous with like that property. And I've heard like, I think she wants to get away from it. I would imagine most creators have like different ideas.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's like when you hit gold, it's like, you strangle that golden goose.
No,
like,
she did. What was that book she did? The first adult book. But it turned into like a miniseries and it didn't do very well.
And that's the problem, yeah. Right? And so she has to go back to digging
out.
But dude, money's.
I agree. I'm not mad at her about it. It's the same. Like the example I would give was like Hideo Kojima. Like he did Metal Gear Solid and it was amazing. And he made a second one and it was amazing. And then he made Zone of Enders and everyone was like, yeah, you should just stick.
Cool though,
it's like cool, that. But it's not Metal Gear. Right, so it's like he has to keep going.
It's like
back.
Directors that are like, I don't want to keep doing the same
right,
series
like,
anymore.
Right, and that's why you see like
Joss Whedon getting like burnt out of Marvel.
Yeah,
stuff.
And so like I think eventually she's just going to write one. I thought, you know.
You know
I,
what? She could ride that money train for a long while.
She's done other books under different writers too, but I don't know.
But I like the way that she carries herself. Like I said, I didn't read the books, but I really enjoyed the movies. And I actually really like the way that she carries herself and she responds to critics. She's very classy about her responses. And
I
enjoy,
British,
I enjoy like reading her Twitter and stuff like that. She's a enjoyable person.
We should do a Harry Potter episode.
Yeah, that's
what
I was
saying. We should definitely do that. I'll watch all of them.
Too bad it wasn't our first
one.
We can call it episode 9 3/4.
Is that what we should do?
Yeah.
9 3/4. Maybe we'll do it eventually. Anything else?
What else did I, so I read that book, I crocheted and knit some Hogwarts house scars for my pugs.
Very productive week.
I love it, I love it.
We saw Bad Mom, saw Rio, no, I think that's
it?
Pretty much about it, yeah.
Alright, that's what you're supposed to ask me.
Oh, David, what are you doing?
No, David, what you doing?
There you go. He with the same.
I'm sorry,
branding.
I enunciate.
Branding, babe.
What
branding.
Are you doing?
We gotta sell the brand. Okay, couple things. I played another game that I bought, not during the Steam sale, but it was around the same time. Actually, it was the Amazon Prime sale. They had Star Wars Battlefront, the first-person shooter online game for like half off. I was going to buy that and then a light for my toilet that lights up. No, I'm just kidding. Did you see all the weird things that Amazon Prime had?
No.
It's like insane, some of the stuff.
I got like a chargeable battery pack for Pokemon.
No, I know, but it's just like... So I started playing this. I played the beta when it came out and I really enjoyed it. And so I played this and it's good. It's the same thing. But the problem is it's always the problem. If you get into a first-person shooter online after like the first round of people stop playing it, the casual players, like you're going to get crushed.
Yeah.
So like it's not fun.
They don't have like a matchmaking...
They do, but the way the game works is like as you, it's a perk system. So as you get kills, you get like these coins that you can then go buy like better grenades and better guns that you can then go into
the
rounds.
The cards or whatever.
Yeah, the cards. It's almost impossible to like get up to, I mean, it's just grinding. It's just brutal, brutal grinding. Now, the only thing the game has that I'm really enjoying is... one, the music is like spot on.
No, the sound on that. I played the beta as well, David, but I didn't like it.
See, I enjoyed the game.
And I held my reservation until I saw more footage when the game actually came out.
Yeah.
And it was just like super disappointed with it. But like the sound and like the way the graphics are amazing.
No, the game looks and sounds
The sound
perfect.
Is amazing.
Yeah.
Like it's all the classic, you know, original trilogy stuff.
Right.
It's just the gameplay is just...
See, I like the gameplay. I actually enjoy the first person.
So meh.
It's faster. It's that kind of that balance between, you know, kind of normal first person shooter and like quick, like Doom. So it's in that kind of that middle part there. But I enjoy the variety of guns and weapons that you get in it. I like how you can get the power-ups where you become heroes. Like, I became Darth Vader one time, and I was just wrecking it, dude. Just, you just walk in, and it's just, like, one of the best feelings in the world. You're grabbing people, choking them, throwing your lightsaber, bouncing back the laser bolts at you, or whatever they're called, laser beams. It's so much fun. The one thing is he moves very slowly, but that fits. Like, you're just, like, walking in like it's no big deal. That sells the game for me. It happens very infrequently because when it pops up, everybody runs for
it's
the
like
power
up. Yeah.
Yeah. But I would recommend it. I think what I'm more interested in will be when they come out with like a second version.
That's the thing. They already announced the second one.
Right. Where it has a campaign and something like that, because it is fun to play, but it gets old quickly because I'm not good enough at it to be competitive, but I'm also,
and you're probably not having fun too, right?
Well, I am having fun, but I'm not dedicated enough to get as good as I could at it because I just don't have the time. And but the Star Wars thing, just hook, line, sinker. It's just like so much fun to play, like the down destroyer, and you hide behind it and you're firing and you're flanking people, and like it's just so
cool.
The
second one, like, please bring back space battles. Like, I know there's a Death Star DLC. That's the last DLC for this one, right?
Yeah, I think so.
And I don't know if it has that kind of thing that they had in Battlefront 2. That's amazing.
Well, see, they have, like, you can get in, like, a TIE fighter, or you can get and it's actually, I was playing with mouse and keyboard. Like, it's almost the game. I know this is, like, heresy, but, like, I almost want to play it with a Xbox controller, because when you jump into the different aircrafts and the different, like, actual, like, AT-STs, it's so hard to control with a mouse and keyboard. Yeah.
You have an Xbox controller plugged in.
Oh, and you just drop it?
And you just use it for the vehicles and stuff.
Okay. I heard that online. You drop it. Okay, got it.
Yeah, and you use mouse and keyboard for, like, your shooting. Yeah, first person shooter. As soon as you jump in the vehicle, just grab the controller.
Yeah, maybe I'll do that. Because I was trying to, like, basically, I just would, like...
It's like Battlefield. Like, have you ever, like, trying to fly in a helicopter in Battlefield 4? Like,
I have. I remember it, yeah. I remember back in the day, like, 1942 Battlefield, and it was just like, oh, God, no. Like, if you could fly a helicopter, it was like, everybody let him fly the helicopter. Yeah. But I would just take the TIE fighters, just kamikaze into like the flip on the other side. Cause it's just like, I can't fly this thing, so I'm not going to hit anything. So let me just drive it into the ground where all the bad guys are. But I would say if you like Star Wars, you got to at least pick it up and play it. I think now it's like $20. It's worth checking out. I wouldn't get all the DLC cause there's a ton of stuff just in the base game.
Of course there is.
The other thing is, some more board games. I actually started,
Shocker.
I know.
What?
This week and last week at my work, we started doing board game nights after work on Thursday, which is like
crazy.
Amazing. Just
That's
amazing.
So crazy.
Like,
get people in your cult.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, come to our side.
The meeple cult.
Exactly. So that's been a lot of fun. And, you know, I start off with some, gateway games. That's what I call them, right? It's like a
hey, man,
like a pusher.
You're gonna start off with some
something not so
heavy. Code names right up in your veins.
Peer pressuring over here.
Like I told him, I was like, we're gonna start you out with like a easy base, and then by the time we're done, you'll be able to be stuffed in a locker like all the other kids. But we did play yesterday. I played with a new game that I want to talk about, which is, I got the box here. Dice Town.
If you're watching this on YouTube, you can see that box.
Dice Town. This is a dice game. Duh.
What?
But it has a Western theme, which I love Western themes in board games. Big fan of that. Because everyone has
What are these little golden
So
things?
Everyone takes five dice. It's like a Yahtzee mechanic. So everyone gets five dice, but these are like poker dice on all six sides of the dice. You have nines, tens, jacks, tens, or queens, kings,
Royal
and aces.
Flush, right?
Right, so, well, you have a nine, too, because five cards, and so you have to have nines. So everyone takes their five dice, and they put them in this, like, it looks like a bullet, like the top of a bullet, and you shake it up, and then you slam it on the table.
Oh, cool.
And then what ends up happening is you'll pick up your bullet, everyone's rolling it simultaneously, and then you pick one of those dice that you want to keep, because you're making a poker hand. But you'll keep one, and you'll keep it underneath the bullet, and then you'll take back the four that you're going to re-roll in the next turn. And then everyone at the same time shows their dice that they kept. So you can start to look, because when everyone's done rolling, then you go to the actual board of the game, and you go through the town. There's these different areas of the town that give you, like a special benefit. But it's like whoever had the most nines in their hand of dice gets to use this. Whoever has the most tens, whoever has the most jacks, whoever has the most queens, whoever has the most kings, and then who has the best poker hand overall. So, it's a lot of fun because, like, for instance, one of the places is the sheriff, which is if you roll the most kings, you become the sheriff until somebody else does. But what's cool about the sheriff is that you break all ties.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's a lot of fun because you're like, at first you're like, what does the sheriff do? That's stupid. I break all ties. But it's like super important because, like, a lot of times you will be the tying with somebody. So you're going to get all the benefits, and then people can bribe the sheriff. If, like, you two are tied and I'm the sheriff, I'm like, okay, well, you guys got to bribe me.
Reminds you of the Game of Thrones, the mechanics.
Yeah, it's got a little bit of that backstabbings kind of stuff. It's a lot of fun. It doesn't take, if you, like, you need to know, like, basic poker hands, like a three of a kind is, you know, straight, flush, poker, yeah, yeah, you know, that kind of stuff. But,
not a problem here.
But what's cool is that everyone's playing simultaneously. I love games that do that because then it's not like this, okay.
You're not doing you're not doing nothing while waiting for someone else,
right,
to turn.
And so you can play with five people at the same time because it's like 2 to 5 players. We played with 4, and it's just real smooth. It's so much fun. And it has that, kinetic part of the game. Like rolling dice in that Yahtzee cup, you know, it's like,
got the one I wanted.
You slam it, you know, and you do that with this game, which is, for some reason, I don't know why that's so much fun. In the Western theme of it kind of comes through. It's got, you know, it's got
the
general store.
The artwork looks really cool.
Yeah,
too.
General store. You rob the bank or you might go to the town hall. It's just really cool. Like at the Queens, or you go to the saloon and you get the ire or the eyes of the girls to,
nice,
and you get to, steal cards from people, which I'm like, it's messed up, but
that's kind of messed up.
Yeah, but it is. It's a lot of fun.
David would not do well in the Wild West.
No, we wouldn't.
Whoa, guys, cheating! Let's stop.
Guys, not cool, guys.
Let's be Law and Order.
Karma, guys, come on, karma.
Do you get to call everybody partner?
Yeah, partner.
Podna.
Podna, and then there's just all, we played like old Western music, you know, like tumbleweed music, yeah, and stuff like that. Yeah. So much fun. So I can't recommend this enough. It's called Dice Town. It's from a couple different designers. Bruno Cathala makes a ton of great games. There's probably a few up on the wall. Just a fantastic game. So that's Dice Town. All right. I think that's all I want to talk about this week because we got more stuff, but I want to get to our reason we got together today. We recently went.
Friendship.
Assembled. The reason why we assembled today.
Exactly. Well, that's a Marvel property. But we're going to do our standard review of the week. This week, we are going to talk about a movie I was very highly anticipating.
Me too.
Yeah.
And people would be surprised by that.
And that is Suicide Squad.
Squad. Oh, I thought we were doing
you were finished each other's
squad.
Okay. Wow. Anyways.
So, we all went and saw Suicide Squad. We all saw it today. We didn't see it all together, but we saw it, today.
Separately.
Not as a squad. Okay. So let's talk about what the movie's about if people are living under a rock and only listen to our podcast.
It's about Will Smith?
No. It is about, it's a DC, it's in the DC universe. It takes place, in that cinematic universe. Essentially, it is a group of bad guys, prisoners, assassins, killers, all these different people. And the U.S. government, headed up by this one character named Amanda Waller, is going to assemble this task force of all these terrible people because she thinks that they can do some good.
Right.
And there's a lot of talk about what happens in Batman versus Superman and, of course, the first Superman movie about, well, what
they
if...
They even make a cut to it.
Right. Right, there's actually some. They make direct references to the other movies. Now,
which I was always curious. This is a direct sequel from Batman vs Superman. In case you're wondering,
I have questions. We'll get into that.
Well, they do have flashbacks, but like,
it happens. Yeah, in chronological order, sort of. And I have a question about that. But
We'll
get to some spoilers. We'll do a whole spoiler section. So don't worry, we're not going to spoil the movie at first. We'll give you forewarning. Essentially, the idea is like, okay, you know, Superman is this metahuman that did these. It has this incredible abilities. What happens when he's not on our side?
The next Superman comes and he decides to rip off the Capitol building. I think is what they said.
They say, yeah, they
that's
grab the
what
president.
They said.
Yeah, rip off the roof of the White House, which is a reference to Superman too, by the way. But which I thought was interesting. So she's assembling this task force and they're put together all these bad guys, kind of in one of your favorite movies, Ocean's 11 type of style. All the bad guys, kind of, they all get their day in the sun to do some good.
Contractors.
Yes. Right. Okay. So now that they know what the movie's about, stars off, of course, Margot Robbie, Will Smith, has Jared Leto as the Joker. You guys know what this movie's about. We're going to give you first our review, what we like, what we didn't like, but we got to do the thumbs first.
Yes.
So here's your standard review.
It's
remember,
my favorite part. Bad movie means thumbs down. Meh movie means thumb to the side. Oh. Good or great movie, thumbs up.
Okay. 1, 2, 3. Okay. So Gerald says thumbs down, bad movie. Me and Sarah both say meh.
And
for me, I actually think for me it's great.
We're doing meh. It's standard.
I know.
It's called the standard review,
no,
David, not standard.
But
accepted.
Good and great have a lot. There's a huge gap between good and great. I would say,
but there's a gap between bad and good. That's what I'm saying. We need a meh. That was meh.
That's fine. Okay. So, anyways, let's talk about without spoiling anything. Obviously, let's talk about what you guys liked about this movie. Let's start with the good parts. Let's start with Gerald since he hated the movie apparently. What did you like?
That means a bad movie, David.
No,
that means I hated it.
It's kind of what.
All right.
What else would you call it?
Yeah.
Positives. All right. I got a few.
Okay. Go ahead.
Jared Leto's partake on the Joker was interesting. Definitely different.
Yes.
Kind of ridiculous in some parts, but it fits. It's the overall, like, he's a gangster more.
Yeah, he's a mob boss type of thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And the take on it wasn't terrible. I was expecting the worst. It could have gone better. Like, the laugh is kind of weird.
And they've shown that in the trailers. Kind
exactly.
Of, he seems like an eccentric mob boss. It's kind of
yeah.
Because he's got all gold on. He's got the gold, like,
I think ridiculous bright purple car.
Yeah, and that's all been in the trailer. So we're not going
to... Again, that's one. But I like the way they took it. Because they're not going to be like, well, we can't copy like Heath Ledger or the Dark Knight. We got to do our own spin. And it was fine.
Like, each person, it seems like each person of the Joker has to put it has to make it their own. Like, it's
which is good that they're not copying.
Type of character. It's a character you have to make on your own.
It's hard, though. We've done it so many times now, like, between, you know, even the animated series.
But if you
have
to do it, do something else. Do your own thing.
Yeah. And, but it always falls into the same problem as, like, remember, anytime you follow up something with, it doesn't matter what it is, it's like, do everything we like, but nothing that we like.
Right.
Right? You know what I mean? So, honestly, I did enjoy it. Keep going. What else did you like?
All right. Let's see. What else? Positive things. Okay. There is humor in this movie.
Yes.
Unlike Batman vs. Superman. Obviously, we're going to make a lot of comparisons here to any of the DC universe. This is the third movie in the universe. But there is comedy.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that.
Some of it is cringeworthy. Some of it is, some of it is, and when I say cringe, I mean like trying too hard. Like,
well, so this is kind of well known that they did reshoots after Batman vs. Superman came out.
Yeah.
And I assume the reshoots were these jokes that just kind of fall flat.
See, I don't think so. I think more of it had
like,
to
crap,
do.
We can't make this as dark as the other one. People don't like that.
Yeah. I think so, but I don't think it was the jokes. I think there was maybe, I don't know.
Okay, so when we were in the theater though, there was a lot of parts where you could tell that was a joke, but nobody was laughing.
Right.
Like maybe like one or two people laughed.
Yeah.
But it's just like I just feel like the
like
jokes
said,
just fell so short. Yeah.
And sometimes that's okay. Sometimes if you go far enough, you know, it's like The Office or Parks and Rec. Like embrace the cringe, like is a good thing. Like, but you have to go that far.
Yeah.
Or you have to have a character that's like Michael Scott, who that's his whole thing, is like saying stuff that's like, oh God, why did they, like, it's funny because you're like, oh, please help him.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Some of the things I felt positive, I like the lead-ins to the Justice League. I'm not going to make any specific spoilers thing, but you could see the seeds.
Yep, they're laying
I like
them,
the
yep.
way they're little. Doing it. That's great. Yeah, I like that. Actually, Zack Snyder directed that. Never mind, we'll talk about it in spoilers part. That's pretty much it. Will Smith is back as
you
Will
like,
Smith.
Okay, so did you like Will Smith as Deadshot?
He's Will Smith, you know.
He's playing. Well, I mean,
he's definitely got the one-liners.
Is he playing Hitch?
It seems like his true serious stuff in the movie. I was like, who Will? It's been a while. Like, I don't know. It just felt
really?
Like his acting. Yeah, a little bit.
No, I think he's played some pretty serious roles.
But I don't know, they definitely centered the movie around him and Margot Robbie.
Right. Well, clearly,
else,
yeah. The two main characters of this are going to be Harley Quinn and Deadshot.
Right.
Which is fine, in my opinion. But okay, what did you like, Sarah?
Yeah, that's pretty much everything on my list.
What did you enjoy about it?
Well, I
why should people go see this movie?
Okay. Well, I didn't grow up reading comics.
Yeah.
I just saw the movies.
Yeah.
You know,
your perspective is a lot different. Yeah. So,
you know, I just saw the movies. I didn't even watch the cartoons.
Did you know who like Harley Quinn was? Like the character?
Vaguely knew who she was, but I mean, I kind of liked it because they did give like kind of like the back, like a little bit like of the background of like each character, and mm-hmm. I
like
that. And, like, they
yeah, I did like
about
the
it.
Montage part,
and that to me helps me because I don't know who these people are. Like
right.
I've
and
never.
It's not
heard...
even you. It's like even people who like casually listen or watch the show and stuff don't know some of these.
Yeah, like
so.
I only know the Joker and Harley Quinn, and that's really it. Those are the only two people that I knew for sure were in the movie, but I don't know the
Kill
other
Croc,
names of the other people.
Croc,
yeah. I don't know that. But
crocodile guy.
I like that they gave a little bit of a background for those people who don't know, and I'm sure that if you're a hardcore fan, you're probably like rolling your eyes. You're like, well, everyone should know that. But
no, it's fine.
And I don't know. I just felt like it was a more enjoyable movie than Batman versus Superman. I liked it. I don't know. I just liked it better. I mean, there are definitely some things I felt forced, but. It just, I don't know. To me, it was just more enjoyable to watch.
Just fun. More fun.
Yeah, exactly. Like
good,
to see
like
the different
good...
characters and stuff like that. And
it's cool seeing, like, you. Just like they said when they announced this property, it's like, how are they going to do this? Like, this is not the traditional superhero movie, you know, because they're all the bad guys.
Right. And so, actually, what I liked about the movie the most is the fact that Marvel, I think people might argue with me about this, but I think DC, in all honesty, has better villains than Marvel does. and that's just my opinion, but I think some
I don't
people
know
might.
The difference, so I'm going to No, but agree. I think
DC's more grounded in reality, if
well,
that's what
you
mean.
Well, they have more gray characters. The characters aren't completely motivated by world domination, right? They have, like Deadshot's motivation has, like, and people will argue with me, but, like, Sandman has similar motivations and...
For his family.
Right. And so it was always interesting for me to be like, oh, cool, let's see the bad guys. Because, and I think a long time ago, Jordan brought this up, is like, you know, like, Loki is an interesting character in the Marvel Universe. He's one of the few for bad guys, villains. But there's a reason, right? He has this little brother complex and, like, and so...
He's an orphan.
Right, and so that creates a good canvas of a bad guy. And this movie, at the beginning, is firing on all cylinders. Like, this movie is fantastic in the first half hour of, like, introducing these bad guys, giving them enough, you know, fleshing out their backstory. And it doesn't obviously need to be an origin story. They're bad guys. We know, like, the trailer actually gives it, like, when she's like, we're the bad guys, remember? Like, yeah. You don't need to paint, you don't need to do the entire background of them. Just show little snippets of it. And I actually enjoyed kind of the overlay of, like, that neon styling of the artwork that they did. And they kind of, like, they would say name, and it would say Harley Quinn, and it would be like, you know.
Like their stats, kind
of. Yeah, their stats. Like that was
some ridiculous, funny stuff in there.
Yeah, and that was great. And so I enjoyed that a lot. But the problem, and this is where I'll start talking about what we didn't like about it, is there's moments in this movie where the characters have some really great dialogue and get to work together. And that's what I thought the movie was going to be. And then they just stop. They stop doing that about halfway through the movie. They go, okay, Will Smith is important. Margot Robbie's characters are important. And that's it.
Yep. Yeah.
And
absolutely.
And it's hard to juggle this many characters, clearly. There's only a few people that can do it. And this just shows, like, and I know people are going to hate me because they'll be like, if you don't like DC, you're in love with Marvel. Like, it's hard to do. Josh Whedon did a good job with Avengers because it's hard to do. You can even see it in the second Avengers.
And people say that a lot. We're like, we talk bad about Batman vs. Superman and all this kind of stuff. Listen, we're not against the DC universe. Like, DC in general. Like, the Nolan Batman movies were some of the best films ever.
Right.
Trust me, I wanted to love that other movie. I mean, I wanted to love it.
That's the thing, like, that pisses me off about this movie is... The trailers were totally sold the movie, a totally different movie to us.
This is the thing, like,
cause and they had the fun parts in the movie that the trailer promised you, but I don't know. It just seemed like the whole movie was going to be like that, like Guardians of the Galaxy, fun, ragtag team, bunch of people with classic music. They pulled that from Guardians of the Galaxy.
And that's fine. I mean, here's the thing, like,
but I was actually hyped for this movie. Batman vs. Superman, I knew it was going to be bad because I saw the trailer. Right. So I went in that movie expecting, oh, this is going to suck.
Right.
But as soon as the reviews started rolling in for this, and they're actually now worse than Batman vs. Superman.
Which it's not worse
than.
No, it's not. It's actually, and I'm being honest about this, here's the thing about this movie, for me. The reason, it's not good and it's not bad. It's just, and I know this sounds like a bad word, but it's just like forgettable.
No, I definitely think it's bad,
it's just
boring.
That's a big problem.
It's long.
And that's the thing, like, it starts off, like, when I started the first half hour of this movie, I was like, how did this get this bad of a review? Like, yeah. This movie is killing it. Like,
it's because it turned into a giant garbage fire. It's just...
And I think, like I said, is like, it's hard to do this, and it's hard to, the kind of the third act of this movie is all over the place. Like, it's just so, it wants to do so many things. And that's, I think the DC universe is always going to unfortunately suffer from because of the Big Brother. And I'm not saying that as like a derogatory term, but like the Marvel Big Brother of like, even the last scene is almost ripped from Guardians of the Galaxy. Like, yeah. I get it. You can definitely be inspired by that movie. It's a great thing to be inspired by. But let's be honest. Guardians of the Galaxy is not the first movie to do this. Dirty Dozen, Ocean's 11. They all have that same motif of like, the bad guys get together this one time, in the case of Ocean's 11, like 8
12
times.
And 13.
Whatever. But they all put aside their own self-dealing and their own self-motivation to get this one last score done, right?
Yeah.
And it's the best part about those movies, because you have so many characters, is the banter, is the interaction, is the different fighting styles, and like one working in connection with the other. And
the pairings you see
and
the chemistry.
They don't do that.
And, you know,
they don't do that in this
movie. They start, like you
it's
said, they
so...
start to. They start to develop a relationship, not like, you know, that kind of relationship, but a good friendship between Deadshot and Harley Quinn, and then
like,
they just, nothing
like
happens.
Like, there's
Can
one
we
line
talk,
that,
like,
we'll about... get to some spoilers, but there's a part when, and this isn't spoiling, Harley Quinn looks at Deadshot and she goes, yeah, my friend. And I was like, this is it. This is what we're, this is what I want.
Yep.
I want like little interactions with these two characters walking and little interaction with these two characters walking. And maybe the two parties get split up and this party has to deal with this. And then they all come together at the end. But it's just like, and they lay the foundation for that. And then it just goes,
falls flat.
And it's almost more frustrating, but I still enjoyed the movie because of the characters. They did a good job, I think, with all the characters at least got like a part in this movie. Like, there's not like a single character where I'm like, why are they in here? Huh?
Slingshot.
What do you mean?
You remember Slingshot in the movie?
Slipknot is his name.
Slipknot.
Well, there's a reason for him in the movie. True. Okay. So anything else you guys want to say before we get into spoiler territory?
Cause no, let's just
go. I'm ready.
You guys are ready? You guys ready?
My body's ready.
Your body's ready. Okay, guys, we're going to get into spoiler territory. If you have not seen the movie, skip ahead. Actually, I think we'll probably just end with this, right? We don't got much more. We're already at like almost an hour. So we'll do spoilers and then we'll end the episode. And then you can come back and listen to it after you've seen the movie. Okay, you are now forewarned. We are going to totally spoil this movie.
Okay, so this is my whole thing is the first Avengers movie.
Mm-hmm.
What I liked about it was that there were all these strong personalities and they fought and they didn't get along with each other and they were really struggling.
The differences between the two. They finally come together.
Yeah, like they were really struggling like to be friends with each other and they didn't trust each other. And I really expected that more out of this movie. I would expect that more out of villains than just a happy-go-lucky, like, well, we're BFFs now. We're gonna, you know, but there was no drama in between them, like you were saying. Like there wasn't like as much like tag teaming anymore. Like it was just like,
here's what I was expecting.
We're all doing this now.
This is totally what I was expecting to happen in this movie a couple times. Like someone's about to take me out and I grab the guy that's fighting with me and I pull him in front of me to take the shot or take the hit. That's like, that's what you want. Like they, you know, but you know, it's, I don't know why that didn't happen more. And I get what you're saying, like where they don't trust each other and they kind of do that at the beginning with he's just like, that's the whole Slipknot thing. Like he's like, we need to get out of here. Right. I actually like the fact that they did that. But as soon as they gave him no backstory, I was like, that dude's dead.
Well, it's funny. The internet was kind of on fire because he's actually a bigger character.
No, he is. He's a big.
And everyone's like, he gets like, there's his face in the trailer. Or like, oh, look, he's a little tiny portrait on the poster. And everyone's just like, oh yeah, he's the first one that's going to go.
Right. But that was pretty obvious.
It's not like coming in my way.
Okay. So I just want to kind of run through the first part of the movie. We'll kind of bounce around, but. Okay, so we get to see the black site in Louisiana. I think it's called, I forget the name of
like
it.
I think it's Bellaroo or something.
Bellaroo,
like
yeah. Love this. I was like in love with it. It's like this black site, crazy prison. I love the intros of Deadshot. I love the intro of Harley Quinn where she's like, he's like, you can't be on the bars. Like we told you. And she's like crazy. And he's like, come in and play with me. And he's like, you destroyed five of my guards. Like that's the kind of stuff I want. Like, and it was villains. Oh
yeah.
My gosh, it was like, I was like,
every
yes.
day, like when they go and be like feeding time, they kick the crap out of him every single time.
Yeah,
you know?
Like I was like, you know, you're making interesting, you're doing interesting things with the characters. I love the little intros that they give, kind of mini intros for, they only do Harley Quinn and Deadshot really, which is like,
they do like a mini one for Croc, mini one for Diablo.
Well, they did that later when Waller has the dinner meeting with the government officials, she's saying about which each one of them is. I heard one's a crocodile guy, which is fine. I liked all that. I liked the neon artwork that pops up, kind of the stats like you're saying. I enjoyed all of that. There was a couple things that I thought were weird, and this is the continuity thing. So it does make reference to Superman because as she's walking into the dinner, they show the shirt that says Superman, the S
and
on
they
it.
They kind of have a cut scene from the Batman vs. Superman.
And then they turn
funeral.
It around
it
and says,
remember.
So, okay, this clearly happens after Batman vs. Superman. So Superman is dead, still is dead.
Whatever.
Right.
Quote unquote.
Right. And then so they show Boomerang doing the heist at the diamond, and then Flash shows up.
Which is cool. Mm-hmm. This is the scene that... Zack Snyder directed, by the way.
Okay. So the problem that I have with this is, okay, so Flash has his suit, right?
Yes.
So, because it makes it feel, and again, I'm all speculating here, it makes it feel like when in the Justice League trailer, when Batman is recruiting the Flash, that he already has his suit. I would think that the Flash didn't have his suit. Like, Batman gave him his suit.
Yeah.
That's
like, he
point.
Was just a kid that was just fast.
We don't know how long after Batman vs. Superman this movie takes place.
No, I know, but it's just...
Superman could have been dead for, like, it could have been 5 years later.
Right, yeah. So my question is Justice League clearly happens after this movie because he talks about, I'm assembling a team,
yeah,
right,
yeah.
In the after-credits scene. So I'm like, so Flash already has his suit. So now that creates an issue with, like...
Who made the suit?
Who made this? And I think about this stuff because
what they're
gonna
do this. They're gonna do this in Justice League where Batman, Bruce Wayne's making the suit, and you're gonna be like, no, that's not what happened. You're messing up the continuity.
Right, exactly. And then Flash will just go in the run in the past and fix it all.
Exactly.
What did you guys think about Batfleck being in this? He's
it's
in
fine.
It.
It fits in. It's like they're trying to build
love,
this universe.
Always. Yeah,
but they're trying to build this universe, and you know, obviously, it's not a great start. But you know, whatever you got to do to get these characters to know, just like the Marvel movies, got to quickly.
Right, but do you like Deadshot's motivation of like his, you know, his daughter? And I love the brutal honesty of his daughter. That scene where they're walking in the snow, and she goes, "Yeah, Mom says you kill people." And I love the scene where he's like, "Yeah, you got to put the money in the account. Now you got to double it for being a jerk." Like. Loved all of that. Like, it's perfect. Like, it's exactly what you needed from.
Does he kill good people though?
He's a contract. He's a.
But he's not one of those things where like, yeah, he kills people, but
doesn't care.
Bad people. Okay.
Doesn't care. Just kills anybody. Gotcha. I actually enjoyed Deadshot's kind of intro and his motivation, how he like lets Batman take him down, and then we.
It works. It makes you like empathetic for a bad person. So.
Right. And I like the. I love. Will Smith, I thought, did a good job when he's like, get out of the way. Like, get out of the way to his daughter, and Batman's just standing there. Which is kind of a punk move on Batman's part, by the way.
That,
Batman.
That's kind of what irked me. I was like, really, Batman? Really?
He, like, pulls her closer. So anyways, I thought that was interesting. But then they spend a lot of time, and they kind of cut to this throughout the movie, is Dr. Harvey or Harley Quinn's origin. I personally loved it. I loved all of the dialogue.
I have questions, David.
Yes, okay.
So we see the relationship. Obviously, she used to work at Arkham Asylum.
Which I loved. I loved all this. This is all part of the traditional canon of Harley Quinn,
right.
Of her origin.
So she was, the tube of stuff that they fall into, what is that?
Well, it's Ace Chemical. So this harkens back to the Killing Joke.
I thought it was like the same.
No, it's all kind of in the same vein of one of the particular... The same thing happened in the original Batman with Keaton. He falls into the bat. So that's a little bit of a callback, but I love the.
Does that like do something to you? Is that the thing?
Yeah, I guess it makes you go crazy. It
makes you pale.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know.
Pasty, yeah.
But I like the electroshock therapy of like setting, making her insane. But she was already empathetic to a sociopath or psychopath.
Yeah, so she was
so
already
like,
heading there.
She was already there, and I love.
The classic costume when they're dancing. Oh my god, that was cool to see.
Yeah, she had it.
The black and the red.
She had the jester outfit on.
Or when she pulls it out of the chest, she's like,
that was great.
That was kind
of
cool.
I love, she calls him Mr. J and Puddin'. Like, those are great callbacks. Like, I think Margot Robbie nailed it.
And you know she's gonna have a Harley Quinn movie. You know it's gonna happen.
Maybe. I don't know, dude.
Maybe not.
This
now,
movie cost them a lot of money, and I don't know if they're gonna make all of it back.
And that was just for Will Smith.
Seriously,
his trailer.
It was kind of funny, the car chase scene, purple car, neon on the bottom, and even what kind of I guess that's Gotham City, could be Midway City, just depends. Kind of had this Joel Schumacher feel, like old school, like Batman and Robin, Batman Forever, like neon,
like ridiculous,
a lot of neon, like the city's not like this dark brooding place, which I don't know if I want or if I do want, because I like the artwork. The neon styling for Suicide Squad, but I don't know if I want the city to look like that.
No.
I love that car chase scene because of the underwater shot when she's like hunched over.
Then
she tries to stab him. I'm like, that's so Harley Quinn. Like, cause Batman will beat the hell out of Harley Quinn in the comics, but it's like, there's a part of you, and they actually make reference throughout the movie of like, I'm not going to not hit you cause you're a girl. Like, I'll jack you up. I don't care.
And she's completely fine with that. She's
right.
Like,
but
no, I'll fight you too.
Right. I enjoy her origin story. I love there's so much, and I don't know if this is, David Ayer's directed it, but it feels like there's moments in this movie where Zack Snyder does like the cinematography of like a very beautiful shot. And he's always been known for that. They do that in this movie, like the vat of acid with the two colors, the red and blue, and he's standing there and he's holding her. And like, that's all gorgeous. Like it's brilliant. Like, but it's kind of like, it's too much. Like it's so like from I don't know.
Do you think it's like out of place?
It's just trying too hard. It's like over the top symbolic cinematography of like, right, we get it that she's now Harley
the
Quinn.
Moment. Yeah,
and it's just like it's so on the nose. And at times I like it because it's fun and it's like pulled from a comic book. But at times it's like the whole thing with DC is like we're grounded in more reality than Marvel. Like we don't have, you know. But it's like there's certain parts of this movie that are just like, oh, you wanted to be hard and gritty, but you gave the boomerang guy a freaking boomerang that has a camera on it. And it's like a drone.
Oh, so dumb.
It's a drone. And I'm like, that's why I'm like.
The killer app joke. Oh, my God.
Yeah, the killer. That's what I'm saying. Like, it's hard for Suicide Squad to fit in this universe because it's pulling two different styles, right? You have the dark and gritty, which this whole movie is super dark. Like,
I was going to mention that. It's literally dark. There's a scene in daylight, and it's like they put a filter over it or something. Yeah. Like, it's still dark. Right. Daylight. It's
okay. Ugh. So then we meet a couple more characters. We meet Diablo, which I actually really like Diablo, except at the end, which...
Yeah.
Well, in the bar scene, like, when he's like, you killed your kids too? And they're like, whoa, like...
I actually like that.
No, I thought it was cool.
I like the bar scene. It felt out of place and felt a little long.
And I was just like, oh,
Jesus, man, we don't kill kids. Like,
yeah.
And that's actually was interesting because I thought... You know, there's...
It was an accident, right?
He got, right. Yeah. But then we meet the Enchantress, which was so, like, I don't know. There's parts that I loved about her, and then there's parts that I were like, what?
I kind of feel like she, like, when she was, like, the dark Enchantress, like, I thought that was cool. But then, like, she morphed into, like...
The witch, the green witch.
Yeah,
with, like, bikini green witch.
Yeah, and I was like, it was too sexy, and, like, she really can't pull off, like, that dark, serious brooding look.
Right, and she's a... Alyssa was telling me, my wife, she's like a supermodel who's now doing an acting career. And like, I'm not saying like she's a villain. She's a bad guy in a superhero movie. Like, you know, there's only a few people that actually pull it off well. Most of them are pretty paper thin, but she was like really paper thin, like Bible page thin. Like, like her acting is not very good in it. And there was times where her audio was off with like her talking. I don't know if that's like a God thing. Like,
when she was the witch, whoa, maybe.
Whoa, right. But it's just like, it just... Maybe I just noticed that because I...
No, I did make a note here that the villain is lame.
Oh,
and,
so
you know,
lame.
Her and her brother and the whole witch thing, it's just super lame.
But and almost like, all of this is forgiven because the Pentagon scene, when she turns into the Enchantress, that hand thing...
That was a cool shot.
Oh,
yeah.
My God. She turns I was him. Like, that was probably the coolest way you could have... Like, the hand comes underneath and then flips it over and then she, oh, I was like...
That was cool.
This is the part of that up until about that point, of the movie, I was like, why is this 26% on Rotten Tomatoes? Like, this movie is nailing it. Like, the transitions
all
of characters.
Third act. But anyway, so, like, I said that the villain was lame. I didn't really get it. They didn't really give her... I mean, I know they did the ancient thing, but it's like...
It was like a Lara Croft thing. And that's part of the actual traditional...
And is this New York? Was it New York?
Well, Midway City is supposed to be, like, think of, like, Chicago. I think
Chicago's Gotham kind of thing?
No, Gotham City...
No, I thought
New
York City was supposed to be, like, Gotham.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I think Metropolis is New York.
Oh, I don't fucking know.
It's one of those things where there's not like specific like cities,
yeah, okay.
But it's a big city like a Chicago. I think.
Okay, I thought it was New York. And these disaster movies have these problems where they're going into battle. Everyone's been evacuated, of course, because some
right.
destruction's going on.
Right.
But there's a mid-credit tease, which stay for the mid-credit tease. I'm sure if you've seen a superhero movie, you know the stay. But there's like, we got people talking about Midway City. We can't let people know. It's like, is this a giant city and giant destruction going on? Like, how do people not know about this?
They're trying
to
keep it all hush-hush. Like, how did they not
show any
just
kind of evacuation? They just
show
up there, yeah.
And the thing why it doesn't make any sense is because everyone knows Superman exists. Like, I think at that point, we're all like, okay, weird stuff's going to happen from now on. Like,
yeah, it's kind of like Marvel. Ever since the aliens invaded and the right, Avengers, everyone knows, like, since the incident, we know this crazy stuff
right.
happens.
Yeah.
Okay, so I wanted to talk a little bit. This relationship between Rick Flag and Dr. June Moon, who is Enchantress, is like, not even there. Like, there's just no motivation.
Some kissing.
There's
her waking up in bed.
It's just
David.
Like, I know we're rushed and I know we have to get through stuff in this movie, but I'm like.
Like, her changing is like supposed to be like super emotional. Like, I don't want to do this. And he's just like, we just got to get it done, you know, so we don't have to do this anymore. The super emotional thing is just like just flat.
Yeah, I know. And like.
Like in the subway, right?
Yeah. Right. And I wanted. And in the comic book, which I haven't like. Read all the Suicide Squad stuff, but I've read stuff about it. I understand that it's kind of like a Jekyll and Hyde thing. Like when she's Dr.
Hulk, Dr. Banner.
Right. It's their version of the Hulk. Like they need her, but like then she takes it too far. Right. And then they're like, oh God, we have to like figure a way to contain her. Like the, you know, it's getting dark out there. It's getting sunset. No, but that's the point, right? That's what,
yeah.
And they don't, that none of that's here. Like, I don't know what the problem is with DC villains getting everything they want so easily, so quickly. Like, come on. She just goes,
she can transport at any time instantly around the earth.
That's fine. I don't mind that super ability. It's the problem of like, okay, we don't have a bad guy. Let's just make let's just give her everything. Okay, she wakes in the middle of the night, and I get it, she's possessed, so maybe she can't control it. She says, Enchantress. She turns into Enchantress. She runs, she finds out her brother is in this thing that they have, opens it up, and I don't know why she chooses a guy in the subway, this poor bastard in the subway washing his hands. There's no reason for that. Picks this guy, gives it to him.
Actually, that was cool how her hands came through the mirror.
I loved, again, a lot of the
creepy, Japanese horror definitely. Stuff is kind of cool.
This guy gets the ability, starts taking out people. I actually like the crystallization thing.
You know, okay, right, Prototype. Remember that game, yeah. Prototype? That's when I read it.
His name's Incubus. So I guess in the comic book, there's this idea that Enchantress kind of does this, I know we keep doing Marvel stuff, but gets possessed by Succubus, who's the sister is, or brother is Incubus. So that's part of it. Kind of like a Dark Phoenix okay. with Jean Grey. And so it's not really her causing, she's not really the villain, Enchantress. It's this other entity that's possessed her who possesses other people. Anyways, I think that was probably too far, but it's just no payoff. The bad guy, she goes into a thing, she gives him it, he gets this crazy power and just starts murdering hundreds of people. Just
I thought it was gonna be relax, I'll call on you, and he's gonna be like, okay, I'm gonna get some food, I'm gonna figure out the study, the civilization out. Nope, just starts killing people.
He
and forms this weird ball thing of different bodies.
Yeah, and then just runs through a subway thing, runs his hand through it.
Immediately starts attacking the
populace. Right, and then that immediately kicks off okay, get the squad together. And it's just why does Lex Luthor get everything he wants? Why does Enchantress there's just no hurdles for these guys, and
the big thing, she's got to get the heart, boom, gets the heart, you know what I mean,
right? And okay, so then she has the heart, she's stabbing it, and she's like, help me, brother, and he gives her some power so that she that doesn't affect her anymore. I'm like, why is everything so easy for all these
and
villains?
It was such a big deal to have the heart so we can end it at any time. She's stabbing it multiple times, it's not working,
right,
start punching it or something.
Yeah, and it's and okay, and then again, I know this is a...
It'd been better if she died right there and then her brother went on a rampage. That would make more sense.
They can't kill characters in any of these movies. Which
they
is
did at the end of the movie. They killed Enchantress.
Maybe.
They crushed her heart, David.
Maybe. That's the problem with so many... And maybe this is just me, being a whiny fanboy. Consequence, man. What consequence? Kill some people. Yeah, you're going to get crap from fans, but... You're gonna have a motive. You're gonna have a punch at the end,
oh. It's the only people that die in this movie are just the Superman. Super innocent people. Yeah.
The one person I didn't ask for them to kill.
The Superman, they killed them kind of.
Yeah, but then they didn't because the rocks float up. Anyways, okay, so then they get the group together. They say we're gonna get the task force together, and then we're going to get in this helicopter and we're gonna fly to the bad guy. And then Katana shows up. And gets little to no backstory. So I'm like, okay.
She got a sword with souls in it.
I kind of felt like she was not she wasn't essential. Feel like she didn't do anything.
She's here to protect
her to
me.
Be there.
That's all you need
she's
to know.
She's like the Wonder Woman in the other movie.
She
just,
really was.
Just there.
Just shows up,
Yeah, and there's clearly some pretty bad dialogue in here, but the part when he's like, she traps the souls of her victims in the sword. It's just you didn't, who cares? It doesn't.
No.
And the part she's talking to the sword, and it's just there's no payoff because you haven't. I don't know who this is other than that she's a badass assassin with a
and she's apparently working with good guys,
right? So she's So that's I guess that's fine, but it's just we had enough. There's parts of me that they're just put everybody in it but then nobody gets paid off. Anyways, that's kind of a minor thing. Then they get shot down, which I was like, who is shooting them? Who was shooting at the helicopter?
These the guys with all the eyes. By the way, I don't like eyes. All right, we've been through this before.
Yeah, but the blob guys never had guns when they were fighting them. They were just jumping at them and attacking.
They had guns with them because they were taking over the army guys that had guns.
I guess.
That sounded like a giant, a tank shot them or something.
Right.
But,
I think this was the part of the movie where I fell asleep.
Maybe.
The thing for me that was, so they crashed down, which is not really necessary. Them crashing, did that pay off to anything?
No, because nothing happened there.
Everyone's everyone survived.
Except the pilot that got shot,
but
shot anyway.
Nameless pilot. But it's just I don't know why you have that. I guess because then they couldn't evacuate?
They could have just landed.
I don't understand.
Maybe it's them walking to instead of flying right in front of the... I don't know.
No, it's you shoot down a helicopter and no one dies, no consequence, and it moves the plot in no way forward.
But the whole... going to the city, David, to take this high-value target. So, I saw this coming from a mile away,
by
the way. Yeah.
Why couldn't she leave? They evacuated the city.
I don't know. Because she was digging up dirt on the other people and stuff, right?
I guess. It's just super weird.
Finding out all the data about the Enchantress, and that's where they got the brother and all that stuff.
I guess. It's just weird. It's just it's just a weird motivation for the character. Now,
I hate how it's there's this global devastating thing happened over here. There's come garbage, in the, but we're going to go after this. And everyone's just like, okay, we got to get this high value target. But it's like, dude, what is that? Like, isn't that
a portal in the sky? Yeah. Maybe we deal with that. Anyways.
That nobody's seen. We're not supposed to talk about it.
Exactly.
Yeah. So they, maybe the whole, now that I think about it, maybe the helicopter was dropped because so they had to do more walking through the city. And
that's what I was saying. Like, they got to get there instead of just landing on top of the building and getting her leaving.
Okay, and then...
So then you can build character exposition, David.
And then, like, okay, so then we get Will Smith. Like, I actually like that scene with Deadshot where he just starts taking out and everyone stops shooting because they're like...
That is cool, yeah.
Jeez, this guy's nuts. And he's like, you know, and that's kind of more motivation. Like, he's not just a mercenary for hire. He's not going to cut and run, which is fine. Like, nothing more. There was a part, like I said, Harley Quinn and Deadshot, they're the ones of this, it's their movie, right? So, the part when he's like, Rick Flagg's being taken away, and she's like, good riddance. And he's like, no, if he dies, like, we all die. And she's like, ah, oh, fine. Like, I love that part, cause that, you know.
Dave, you know what I didn't like, though? I hate that, like, they sent in, right, another army team, right? They're not the first
Bravo
team.
Bravo team, yeah.
Yeah, Bravo team, whatever. They have guns, all this kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And they got captured, like, immediately, apparently,
of
all
course,
alive.
Yes.
Harley Quinn has a freaking wooden baseball bat and smashed in the heads of all these eye creatures.
Listen.
No problem.
You don't need karate, you just need karaze, alright?
That's like, she's crazy, and, like, she's a wordsmith, and she obviously will do anything for the Joker, whatever, but her thing is she can shoot, which is great and all, and she can hit people with a baseball bat.
She's a metahuman, so stop with like trying to explain.
She's not,
why
she's just a crazy human.
Well, she fell into a vat of chemicals, okay? Whatever. Stop. I'm not gonna worry about like the...
It's real water.
Right. Oh, geez, wow. Okay, so then we meet, we get to the top of the building. We get the backstory of they're gonna deactivate the bomb inside their neck. I actually liked Amanda Waller's, like, just taking out her people, like showing how she's really the bad guy, right?
Yeah.
I mean, at the end of the day, like, she will, the means always justify the ends to her. And that's like the ultimate bad guy.
And I get that, and I'd be like, oh, we'll cover it up. But it's like, dude, you just like flat out shot these employees of some government agency.
And that's what I think.
With witnesses showing you don't care. Like,
and that's what I wanted.
How's that possible?
I wanted the movie to be this, like, the bad guys are bad, but they do it just because, you know, like, they're, I'm trying to think
they're
of a way
to say it. They're doing it for themselves.
Well, yeah, but it's
self-gain.
Not, like, it's not, they're, the quote unquote good guys are not technically the good guys, because they'll expend any resource and do anything that's necessary to justify the ends. And I thought, like, ooh, that's interesting. Let's run with that. But in reality, Amanda Waller created all these problems that end up ending the world, right? Because
yeah.
She let Enchantress go and all this stuff, and she couldn't control the things that she thought she could. Then we get this, there's a scene when they're going up the, stairs. And Harley Quinn has this moment where she's having the conversation with Joker, and this is and he says, will you die for me? And she says, yes. And he's like, will you live for me? And I was like, why is this not the movie? Like, this is what I want. I want, like, interesting dialogue, like, between characters. Even the action in this, like, you never get that moment where, like, Harley Quinn does something that works in continuity with Captain Boomerang, and then his Boomerang does this with Deadshot's weapon, or, like, Boomerang throws it, and then he shoots a bullet off
of it.
You
want, like, a kind of a meta Avengers kind of thing. The meta...
Because that's fun!
Yeah.
Because you're... The fun
but
thing,
these movies aren't fun, David. We've been over.
No, that's not true. There are moments of the fight scenes that are interesting, and like the elevator scene with Harley Quinn is fantastic.
Yeah,
I loved all that. But it would be more interesting if it was with the other characters, because that's the whole point of this, is like everyone got together.
Yeah, but then you get the moment for stepping out. It's like, hey, what's up? Let's go. You know. By the way, I don't know how many gratuitous shots of Margot Robbie's butt they had to show in this movie.
Well, there's even the shot where it's like in between her crotch when she gets hit, and I'm like,
yeah,
oh, come on.
Yeah, yeah, like, we get it. She's hot.
I know, but hey,
she can't wear shorts.
I know, but it's also Harley Quinn's character to some extent. But that's fine. I mean, you're taking the original artwork is like totally sexualized. I mean, come on. Then we see, I thought for a second Deadshot shot her. And I was like, I even grabbed the list. I was like, oh, what? They're going to kill off Harley Quinn. But of course they don't.
Yeah.
And I'm like, why didn't you? That would have been huge. That would have been like,
because you can't have her in the next
Ned
movie,
Stark.
David.
Like, I know.
But, oh, and by how many not lives does Joker have? Didn't he die twice in this movie and it's not even explained?
That's
survives
fine.
A helicopter
Joker.
Crash.
He's Joker. That's
the, yeah, I was going to say, there was the car crash.
The car where he just like disappeared and he didn't go through the windshield like Harley Quinn. He's just gone.
Yeah, I know.
I guess he ducked out, but Batman couldn't see him.
That's so rude.
Right. Okay. So stupid. So finally, you know, Harley Quinn's all upset because she thinks Joker's dead. And now her motivations are weird because she knows she's not gonna, her head's not going to explode. And so she's just kind of like, oh, I'll hang out with you guys. I missed you guys.
Which, she's good now.
Not really. Like, she's still not. Then the bar scene happens, which part of me was like, this is going on way too long. And I couldn't understand what Killer Croc was saying, like, half the time.
Yeah.
Like, it, like,
he's like a gangster Jamaican. It's actually played by Mr. Echo from Lost.
Yes.
Mr. Echo.
I actually thought it looked great. I actually thought it was going to look really weird, but it looked really good.
Okay. Yeah,
it was
coming for more crocodile.
Like, his head, he had more head makeup on his head or pieces
than, like,
than his body. Yeah. So, like, his head looked really big, but his body looked smaller. And
right.
It looked kind of weird. That looks fine.
Then, okay, so then we get, like, basically the third act of the movie, the train station. And this is where...
Such hot garbage.
This is where the movie just, for me, just goes, like, okay, like... And it has...
What
again,
is happening?
There's a moment of, like, ooh, I like what they're doing here. I like the part with the Enchantress like is tricking all of them into what they really want. You know,
kind
with Deadshot.
Like a, what is her name? The Scarlet Witch.
Yeah, and Avengers
no,
too.
Absolutely. Yeah. And also just like a Matrix thing, right? Like, it's like, I can change your reality and make it so you're happy instead of having to deal with all these problems. And like,
but then it's like, then like Diablo just somehow knows, it's like, it's fake, guys. It's fake.
First of all, that scene was so forced. Like, it's, okay, me and Alyssa were talking about this. Like, you're into like drugs and like, and I'm not saying everybody who gets tattoos is a bad person, but I'm saying anybody who gets tattoos all over their face, including a scythe of what death uses and Diablo
on your
under,
forehead and like, yeah, Diablo on your, like, face is tattooed like
and
a skull.
Yeah. He looks like an actual skull. Like, probably not a Family Guy, like probably into some stuff. And then she's like, it would have been fine if she comes up, oh yeah, I'll put the kids to bed, and then, you know, but then she says, and we can chill. I'm like, really?
No,
like,
she says, and then we can kick it or something.
Yeah,
like,
and
that.
I'm like, this, like, is so cringeworthy. Yeah. All she had to do was just walk down the steps and look at him, and like,
and he
looks
just
at
looks
his
to
kids.
Look at his kids, and boom, that's it.
Yeah. That's all you needed. I didn't need like a, like her in like basically the blowjob position telling him that they're gonna kick it. I was like, this is dumb. Why are you doing this? And so
then he turns into something more dumb.
Oh, and then,
and I don't, like I said,
oh,
I don't,
like,
I don't know the comics,
fruit.
But he's like a demon, like a, like he said, like, I'm from hell, whatever.
No, and he looks like a Mayan.
Yeah.
Like, it's weird. I don't, and that CGI
looks
bad.
But then he also looks like Groot, kind of, in a
yeah,
way.
Yeah, it's know. Just the CGI looks bad. Like, the bad guy's bad already, and like, Enchantress is bad. And then, like, again, there's this idea of like, and I get it, it's a superhero movie, but like, you're fighting this all-powerful being. And you're like, it seems like there's like, we got to have a fight scene, of course. And then at the very end, she just steals all their weapons and all their stuff. And it's just like, you can't
but
make...
no, now you're worthy.
Right, but now, yeah, and that's the point,
oh,
is like...
So it... did he die?
Who?
Diablo.
I'm guessing. Yeah. Until they bring him back.
He's the scoop of his ashes.
Who actually was interesting to a certain extent.
But, okay, what I don't like, and that's kind of, that brings back to the same thing, is you need this super powerful Diablo guy to defeat this demon. It's like, oh no, place him over the human C4. That'll kill
him.
And
I'm
the
like,
C4
why don't they
kills
just...
him, but not the big fire demon.
Right, and I'm like, why don't, you know, I get the heart, you have to literally cut the heart out, but like, drop a nuke. Or drop like a huge bomb and blow up that
everyone's evacuated, right?
Right. Yeah. I'm like, that's the problem with these, you know, because they can't, I guess bombs and guns have to work, because that's what we do. Like, it's just... But it's always the problem if you make a bad guy so powerful when they're fighting it and the bad guy eventually goes, shows all their power, it's pointless.
Yeah.
It takes away like, oh, well, they never had a chance anyways.
They should have done just like a smaller villain or something, man.
I don't know what you do because...
Just her brother.
Well,
I don't know.
I always... This is what I wanted the movie to be. And there's an animated movie called Assault on Arkham, and it has to do with the Suicide Squad. And Joker, and I thought, okay, let's talk about this. Joker's not in this movie. Like, he's in it for
like
12 minutes.
15 minutes, yeah.
And like, you know, if you're gonna put Joker in the movie, and I guess there's some deleted scenes, there's like 10 minutes that got cut, and Jared Leto's already upset about how little he's in it, or I don't know what's going on.
Javier said, like, this is my cut. It wasn't like the studio influence or anything. Like, this is my cut. This is what I wanted it. But yeah, there is more Joker footage out there.
Yeah, but it's just like, he's just not in it enough. And
well, like I said before, like, the trailer sold a totally different movie than this movie really is.
Yeah, but, I thought the movie was going to be Suicide Squad is trying to get this task done, whatever the task is. It doesn't matter. Get a high profiled VIP out of a building or something without them being killed. And then Joker was going to essentially learn about that through Harley and obviously is trying to save her, but at the same time is trying to just create havoc, right? Like,
that's
make, kill all the other guys and make Harley live. And so he was going to be the antagonist of just being a, like, a pain in the ass. But like, high stakes of like
killing off members,
right?
One by one
we have to kill Joker in addition to getting this done. So then Joker becomes a bad guy among bad guys. But Harley's torn between, like, she starts to be friends with Deadshot. And then in the Arkham thing, there's, like, this in-between Joker, Deadshot, and Harley. And I thought that was good, because when she says, we're friends, and she starts to be like, they have a relationship. That would have been better. Instead, you've got to turn, and then the Joker could just be, he doesn't have any motivation. That's why it's awesome. Because he's just creating, like, I just want you guys to fail and I'll die and I want to save Harley. Like, that's fun.
Just, they just need to dial everything down. Everything's just like, we got to have the villains. It's going to destroy the world. Do all this crazy stuff.
I'm so tired of, like, the world-ending stuff. Like,
yeah,
why does everything
just, like,
have to
dial
be the
dial it back. Why can't it just be a, like Joker in Dark Knight? Like, just a really bad guy on the streets of this one city. Why does it have to be this global devastation thing every time? It's just...
And I get it. The meta-human thing they're trying to play
that
out.
I actually kind of didn't understand what they were going for. It seemed to me like all they were doing was just knocking out the power. Like electricity. Like, that's all it looked like to me.
Right. And, like, the lightning thing that can shoot from, like,
I'm building this big machine. I'm still building this machine. I'm almost done building my machine. What's the machine? We don't know.
Yeah. What does it do?
It's going to end all civilization, I guess, though.
I don't know. Then there is the scene at the very end of this movie with the extremely long slow motion shot of Deadshot and the throwing of the bomb into the machine that,
that
takes
so ridiculous.
So long.
Yeah, I remember watching
Come
the scene and being
on.
Like, okay, so
the
is he gonna
slow
shoot
mo of his reaction looking at his daughter.
And I actually like that Enchantress did that and said she put that into his head. That's
but
what
then
I'm thinking.
This is the whole thing is like, okay, but then Diablo just told you not even 5 minutes ago it's all fake.
No, and he gets it.
He gets it, and he's basically
but
saying
it's his daughter.
No, but I mean, it's like he obviously knows that that's not really her. Like, then just take the shot already. Like,
and he figures out it's just the slow mo and the dramatic.
No, it's just it's over the top dramatic, like to the point where it's like, it's like Chariots of Fire, whatever that song is, where it's like. Okay, dude. Like, it's like
in the rain, all full cap, full face shot of Will Smith.
It's just like, and he goes, ah, just like, come on. And you know, the way that you know Enchantress dies, and
that is so stupid,
it's so bad.
Peels back the makeup of Enchantress as the actress.
I want to talk about so the guy. I forget what his name is, but he goes up. He's like, I have your heart, and he just like crushes it a little bit, and then she's dead. Like, what?
Right. And that's okay.
Why didn't the Fuller chick just do that? Just crumble it up? Instead of stabbing it with a pencil.
I don't know. Like I said, there's well, she got the power from the machine and her brother. Like I said, there's some continuity problems. And again, that part I really don't care about. It's just there's some weird cutting and editing in this movie. And that might be because of the reshoots. Like I said, there's like parts where like Rick Flag, his character's like hair changes multiple times. But I can forgive all that. It's just the movie is just boring.
It's boring. Yeah.
It's a really boring movie when it could have been like I was hoping, and I'm surprised they didn't go rated R with this because they should have. Like, why not? I don't mind that the bad guys are just like aliens because that's what we're always going to get because it's easier to kill a bunch of nameless, faceless people and it's easier for the ratings.
You don't feel bad. Yeah.
Right. But hey, these are bad guys. We should kind of toe the line between like, I don't know if I like cheering for these people. Like, yeah. You know, there's a lot
really
of...
make you feel that split, like, right. That, like, ooh, that gray area.
And you just never feel like that, because you knew from the very beginning, like, Will Smith's doing this for his daughters. He's not... There's never going to be that conflict of doing the right or wrong thing.
Mm.
Even when they try to build it up with shooting Harley Quinn, he's just like, he's not going to do it.
Mm. Yeah, and so, of course, that the very, very end, Joker shows up, takes Harley Quinn out, so now we're going to have, I'm guessing, Joker and Harley Quinn in the next Batman standalone new DC Universe movie.
Yeah, it depends if they're going to do kind of like prequel to Batman vs. Superman or sequel.
Yes.
I think they are. That's why the continuity of this is all weird, because again, the Robin costume of like, Robin was killed.
That already happened from the Joker.
Yeah.
Right, that's
what
why like, there's some continuity issues, but they do make reference that Joker's been around, and he was in, and so he's the, you know, clown prince of crime, and they make notes about that, and so again, there's so many parts in this, like, it's hard for me. It's like there's bad parts, but then there's really funny, good parts of like interesting. But you had so many opportunities to have interesting relationships between these bad guys who are probably never going to get together again, ever. Like, it's just not going to happen because one, the ratings. And then two, it's just hard to get, a big cast like this. Like Avengers, like as much as we bitch and moan about the second one, like it's probably not going to happen. Like, and even Captain America, like, that stuff's just too hard to pull off.
We're talking about those. Another Avengers movie coming up.
But I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong, but it just feels like... what those movies do is they celebrate different characters' relationships.
Yeah.
Like, the thing between Vision and Scarlet Witch is a little bit in there. And then, like, the thing between Scarlet Witch and Hawkeye in the second movie. And then, like, Captain America and Tony Stark and Iron Man in Civil War. Like, characters get time with each other. And some get it in the beginning of this movie, and then they stop.
Well, see, so yeah. When they show that Harley Quinn was actually a psychiatrist, I was kind of hoping they would go into, like, she kind of, like, analyzes them a little bit.
Like, right, like, she does the detective work. Yeah.
And is like, oh, like, or, you know, maybe, like, kind of, like, makes fun of them a little bit. Like, oh, well, you say this because you have daddy issues. Or, you know, like, something like that. He, like, uses that. Oh,
like, her psychiatrist comes out.
And right, and she actually kind of does at the end. She's like, we own it. Like, yeah. Hey, when, you know, like, say it. Say you killed your kids. And like I said, I was hoping more of, and that, again, there's parts in the trailer that aren't, because they talk about, like, water. Yeah, water for you.
It's from the trailer, like, Joker's face is all half burnt and stuff. That doesn't happen in the movie.
Yeah. There's some weird, I just want to talk about one other thing and then we'll wrap it up. There's the part when Jared Leto's sitting and there's all the knives around him. There's like baby clothes. Did you guys see that?
The only thing I got from that was he's investigating like all the different people that's involved with Harley Quinn.
Yeah.
And maybe that's like old, because he had laptops out next to that stuff.
Yeah, but I love the her dream. I love the push of the normal cycle.
Oh, yeah.
And she's like, there's no more normal for us.
Yeah.
And
No, she even says, like, normal is just a cycle or something like that. Or normal is a setting or something like that.
Yeah, and then, like, you see her in no makeup and then Jared Leto's there with the two kids. I was like...
In normal hair.
Like, all she really wants is... She's actually in love with the Joker and just wants to have a normal... Would prefer to have a normal life, but she doesn't think they ever can. And I was hoping, like... I hope that they take that somewhere.
They definitely
like,
will.
I hope that there's a moment where, like, Joker does something so, like... despicable that even she's like, I can't follow you. Like the kid thing. Like, I can't kill kids. What's wrong with you? And he's like, what do you mean? We're crazy. And she's like, I'm not that crazy. I hope they do something with that, but they probably won't. Cause like, it's just
asking for too much.
David. I don't know why it's weird. This movie's just, unfortunately, it's just meh. And it's like, it doesn't even elicit that much of a reaction from me in the aspect of like, how does this fit? Like, nothing advances, nothing moves forward. Like, Joker and Harley are out. All of the, like, Deadshot gets to see his daughter, but he's still in prison. Like, nothing is advanced with this movie.
Croc's got a TV now in his sewage.
Nothing is advanced. Like,
watching music videos.
The only thing that's advanced is like, that didn't work. And Batman gets the files on the Flash on Aquaman to get the Justice League. That's all that this movie pushes the, like, at least Batman versus Superman, like, pushes forward, like, certain plots that will run as an entire thing of, like, collateral damage. Like, what is
the Marvel movies? We got another Stone, guys. Remember that movie that's coming up? Like, everything progresses the overarching of the universe. This doesn't do any of that.
It just feels like we had an Ocean's 11 and it has no consequence moving forward. And that's
the only thing that I can think is, like you're saying, they're setting the stage for Joker, they're setting the stage for the characters that we're inevitably going to see in other movies.
But you could have done an origin of Harley Quinn and you could have done an origin of Joker. Well, I don't think they even need to. You know my feelings about doing an origin for Joker. It's scarier when he doesn't have one. But it's just like, it's just kind of meh. It's not terrible. I enjoyed it. It had funny parts. It had good action. I like the characters. I like the interpretation of the characters. I can say that. Everybody, even Captain Boomerang, which is like such a, like, I actually like the guy who played him. I thought he had some good lines. Like, you know.
Freaking Jake Courtney. the discount Tom Hardy.
Yeah, but it's just like, it's just, they don't do enough with it. And I thought, because David Ayer did The Fury, he did End of Watch, like, he's done good, like, movies, like, but it's just, I think this suffers from screenplay issues and rewrites and
probably studio intervention.
Even the action scenes are boring because the characters are just, it's like a one-on battle with everybody. This guy's fighting this guy, this person's, but, and it may be because they just don't use their, they don't really all have superhero powers. They're all just, like, skilled in, like, shooting or throwing or hitting a baseball bat. And, like, the one time we get to see this awesome, like, cool thing, it's just, you don't even see you don't even see the other bad guys. He just torches the stairs.
Yeah.
He lit some stairs on fire or like levels of like, I'm like, we didn't even see like at the end you get a little bit of it, like the cool special effects of like the guy on fire flailing, but like you don't get any of that. So it's just like, and even that little moment where he's like, I was just trying to get you there was great, but that was shown in the trailer. So like, I want more. You got to give me more than what your trailer offers. Again, I really wanted to like this movie.
That's the thing I was saying. Like, the trailer sold me this movie that looks like it was going to be fun and action and just totally against the norm. And it was just boring and flat and predictable.
But the first 40 minutes, like, I don't know how you nail it so well in the beginning.
And then they show an early cut to the studios. They didn't like it. Reshoots are scheduled. So it's too much studio intervention in these movies, man. If you want these to succeed, let the creative people do their thing.
Yeah.
It just sucks. Money.
I'm worried about DC. You keep getting 26 on.
I said this before.
And that's not even from me personally, because I think it's way better than 26. I think it's way better. I think it's probably at least a 60. I think it's, what's certified fresh? 70?
Yeah, anything over 60. I think it's 61.
I think it'd be like a 61. I think it's enjoyable. I would tell people to go see it if they're DC comic book fans, but if you're not, don't, because nothing there for you.
Well, I definitely don't think it's that good, but it's definitely better than Batman vs Superman.
But but you keep getting 20s and 30s on Rotten Tomatoes, it will catch up with you. Like, people will stop seeing your
Batman
movies.
Superman, yeah. Like, I'm worried about this universe because I want it to succeed, because I like seeing these characters on screen. Who doesn't? What nerd doesn't want to see Batman Superman on screen and them do really well? Say, man, Suicide Squad looks really good.
Yeah.
But man, if that bombs, they're going to have a huge problem. And well, I definitely do. Like,
they need to figure out, their marketing team needs to talk to the people who made the movie, because they keep doing this. Like, Batman versus Superman was like Batman versus Superman, this awesome battle that we're going to see. It was like 5-6 minutes long, which is.
Yeah, I was going to say it wasn't very long.
No, it's not very long. And it's not this, it's just a fight scene. And then, like, they become bros as soon as, like, Martha said, like, it's too fast. And then, like, you have the Suicide Squad, which is like Ocean's 11, this crazy, and it's just no interaction. It's just, they're bad guys and they're going to get this done, and like,
then go back to regular life.
So now, I mean, you probably saw the same show,
Wonder Woman.
You probably got
Wonder Woman. Yep.
So that's hopefully going to be the first good DC universe.
It could be. I think it has the potential, but they need to stop trying to cash in on shots, these cinematic shots of just.
Well, Justice League's after that, so.
We'll see.
I got plenty of garbage in
there. All right. Well, that's our take on Suicide Squad. Don't hate us so much, DC fans. I honestly want to like these movies.
This movie let me down.
And I actually think DC does overall, I think I like DC animated movies more than I even like the Marvel live action movies. So it's not like DC can't do good movies. I enjoy those so much. They're so good. Why just do those? Just reenact those in life.
Those aren't realistic, David.
It doesn't matter.
It's got to be grounded. It's dark, gritty.
Anyways, all right, let's wrap it up. Again, if you are listening to the audio version, go to youtube.com/sitdownstandard.
Subscribe, comment, like, thumbs up.
You can always
Twitter, tell your friends. Instagram, Facebook.
Let us know what you thought about Suicide Squad if you saw it. You can shoot us an email. What's the email, Sarah?
Is it sitdownstandard@?
Come on.
You got this.
Come on.
I believe in you.
It's not usgov.com.
Yeah, we got.
No, we don't have a gov domain yet.
we'll
it's sitdownstandard@gmail.com.
Yeah, sitdownstandard@gmail.com. Send us your questions. Remember, if you send us a question, we'll pick it if it's the best question of the week. And then you get a $5 gift card to Amazon,
Starbucks
or Steam. You will like one of those three. Again, I'm confident that you will like one of those.
Amazon has freaking everything.
Huh? Everybody needs something off of Amazon.
Exactly. Yeah. You can buy more Amazon gift cards. What?
True.
I actually saw that the other day. You can buy an anyways. Let's wrap it up. Till next time. Bye.
Bye.
See ya.